morning, and welcome to another exciting broadcast day.
Yes, it is. Plenty of show today. We're going to do a little Passover Seder. Also, our religious week will continue. We'll have a Scientologist in studio. Tori Spelling's coming in. Dick Vitale, part of the show. I had Teresa Strasser. Welcome back.
Thank you for having me back.
Teresa's going to be doing the news today. I had a conversation with Tad about 20 seconds ago that I realized is now. I need to go on to about 125, maybe 130 to win back the part of my life where it's sort of confused. I call them Green Acres conversations. You ever watch the old sitcom Green Acres? The guy was essentially trapped inside a bad dream. Nobody understood what he was saying. Everyone, you know, they talk about Arnold the pig. Thank you, Tad. It was always confusing, and he was the only guy who was confused. And the entire town was confused, except for he was the odd man out, because no one understood him. Mm-hmm. But I realized, Tad, you may be excused. Had that conversation with Big Tad 20 seconds ago where I said, Tad, give me a coffee, just a little milk. All right. Then about 3 seconds later, he says, so, cream or sugar? And I said, No sugar. Cream? No, just milk. Just milk. You want a cup of milk? Okay. Where do I get that? Do I get that time back? That's a good, valuable 30 seconds there that was just lost with that conversation. But I realized if I added up all those conversations and try to build a house with Oswaldo, by the way, but if I added up those conversations, I could lead a second life.
Mm-hmm. Are you effing stupid?
This is why I've advanced in the past my idea of time-saving conversation things. Like,
yes.
For instance, a.m., p.m. People, we always say, what time is it? 8 o'clock. Is that a.m. or p.m.? Here's my move that we, from now on, since we all know what you're talking about, you just take out the M. It's 8 a.m. or 8 p.m.
Mm.
And listen, I know that seems like nothing. That's only a half a second maybe you're saving. But over the course of a life, 15, 20 minutes saved.
Mm. I would say the same for BM.
Right.
Because
B.
Yeah, no one says, I took a bow. Hold on. What? What's he going to say? Oh, movement.
See?
Interesting.
When we can save time, let's do it.
Let's do it. All right. Dante?
Hey.
I'm going to call you Dan. Try to save some time. Dante works over at the Circus of Books. He called in, I believe, earlier this week, or was it last week? And I'm losing track.
No,
this week. Monday or Tuesday. You work at the Circus of Books, which is a porn bookstore, right?
No, we have other stuff, but mostly, yeah.
Oh, you have some bondage stuff? What do you have other than porn?
A few months ago, we started selling mainstream movies also.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
It's nice to give somebody some legitimate something. It's like a fast food place should have one salad on the menu so I can go up there, get the nuggets, get the fries, get the chili size, get the chili dog, and then I'll get the salad and I'll walk out feeling like I made the right move. I'll go to your place, I'll go in there, I'll load up on the big top horn and the Bangus Uranus, and then I'll just go in there and get like Hudson Hawk and walk out with a certain dignity.
Right, or maybe a copy of Tuesdays with Maury.
Yeah, you sell, has that been turned into a movie now?
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Oh, it has.
Yeah, it was bad, too.
Oh, it was bad. Came and went. All right. So anyway, Dante, is anyone in there yet?
Yes.
Oh, really? Six?
Yeah.
You open at 6 a.m.?
Yes.
It's barely 6:04 now. Do people wait to get in there?
Most of the time, yes.
I never, you really feel like you bottomed out. You really feel like you have a problem when you're waiting to get into a store. One day, I was working out in Van Nuys and decided, when I was working for myself, I used to like to start work about 8:45 in the morning and knock off for lunch about 10:30, 10:45. And me and my slacky partner decided we should go eat some ribs at a rib joint. But it was about 10:50, and the place didn't open until 11, and it was just me, him, and one morbidly obese guy. I'm talking about made Tad look like a mosquito. Size guy just standing there with their nose pressed up against the window waiting for the nice lady to unlock the door. And I thought, wow, this is pathetic. And I thought, if you're a fat guy, you should not be waiting for the rib joint. You should casually, the wind should blow you in an hour after it's open. You should pretend like you got lost. So who waits to come in there? And what is it that's so important at 6 a.m. with the porn?
Well, besides the newspaper.
And want to get the newspaper?
Yeah, we get the newspaper.
So. Yeah. You can't get a newspaper any other place in town but the porn store. I will have my boy drive down the hill every morning about 5:30 to go to the Circus of Books in West L.A. so he can get me a Times. And then it's right back up the hill. They should start putting them in those vending machines and stuff or even offer a delivery service of some sort. Nobody's buying. They come in there and act like they're looking at the new, oh, what do we have here? USA Today. Wow. And then they go through the regular section, and then they get into the porn section, right?
It happens.
All right, so the guy's in there. Can we talk to him?
I don't think so.
Why? He looks gay?
That's not the problem.
What percentage of the guys who come in there are gay?
Probably 80.
Yeah.
Good Christ, I'm gay.
If you have to make that blowing sound, it's over 75%. if you say, what percentage gay? I don't care if it's on a cruise ship or in the mall, and you hear... it's always... you ought to not even answer. Just... means it's over 75%. That's how you know. What percentage of priest, your Catholic priest, do you think are actually gay? Any sound, actually, if I hear that for anything, I'll just assume over 75%.
Yeah, I'm about to buy this neighborhood. How's the crime rate?
Yeah. You want to set Not me good. Up? You want to set me up with your sister? Is she a big gal? You hear that long wind sound? It's just time to cut your losses. So you figure about 80% gay.
Yeah.
Now, why is that? Because of the part of town you're in?
Yeah, part of town.
Are you in West L.A.?
No, West Hollywood.
West Hollywood. Whereabouts are you?
In Santa Monica and La Jolla.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's getting into Boys Town, right?
Oh, yeah, that's very good.
It's not getting into it. It is it.
Yeah, it is it. Do you guys have the West Hollywood Sheriff's patrol your neighborhood?
Yeah.
Do you see the jumbled gay flag on the side of the cruiser?
No.
Come on, you've seen that.
They don't have a flag on the side.
It's a jumbled gay flag.
Right, it's the colors of the rainbow.
It's the colors of the gay flag that have been jumbled up into a mosaic.
No, they just seem a little unhappier than that.
Oh, listen, start noticing the side of their car. You'd be unhappy if you had the gay flag on your cruiser, too. Didn't get into that to put the gay flag on my cruiser. I got into takedown perps. Yes, now not bus guys with herps.
This exposure to the gay material. You ever on a Saturday night after a long week, you say, I'll give it a shot.
Oh, Dante may
take some have
the gay porn to the punch. Dante, you're gay, right?
No.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, you know, to me, that would be, you know, like a diabetic working in a donut shop. It just, what's in it for you?
It's a job.
No, I know everything's a job, but... You could do better than, you know, if you're going to man the sort of store and it's gay, you have gay clientele. Wouldn't it be nice to be gay?
No, it's cool working here. It's not like I said I want to work in a, you know, a porn place, period. It wasn't a goal, and then I just ended up here.
Mm. Yeah. What are you getting an hour over there?
I'm not telling you.
Yeah, because it's humiliating.
No, it's pretty good.
He's getting paid in semen.
I've been here for a while.
Hey, yeah, golden time. Oh, can't say urinated on? We can say urinated on. Sure you can. All right. Come on. What kind of tight society are we living in? So like, if you work a weekend shift, you get like 3 buckets?
No, 2.5.
Oh, wow.
Oh, times are tough.
And then, of course, whoever's backing you, whoever's restocking the shelves, you got to tip a little his way. A little splash.
Well, I don't want to seem greedy.
Now put a customer on the phone.
Yeah, come on. There's got to be a guy in there that looks cool.
No.
Really?
Yeah. If there was some way for you to see this, no.
I'll tell you, we'll give, ask if anyone wants to go on the phone, they get a Hooters gift certificate. Ironically, that's all we have here.
Gay men love Hooters.
Yeah. That's right.
That's
we're,
so
we're, giving away umbrellas in hell. Yeah, what are they going to do with the Hooters? Gay guys don't like wings, they don't like onion rings, they don't like tea or A, and they certainly don't like college hoops. Or they wouldn't be in the predicament they're in today.
But I'm sure they'd like to wear those orange shorts.
Well, that's true.
In fact, see, the whole outfit, the little bunchy socks and the,
yeah,
the tanks,
yeah,
tank tops.
Dante, you know we're talking to you on the radio, right? You're fine with this?
Yeah.
All right, you're a good man. Look, I'm glad to have a guy on the inside, such as yourself, pardon the pun. I just think it would be nice to get one of the fine patrons over there on the blower. Give him that Hooters gift certificate. You want it? Do you have a PA system over there?
Yeah, but where I am, as you say, standing on six crates, I can see everybody who's in
here. Sure.
There's no need to use a PA right now.
It's kind of one of those. It's one of those weird. It's a weird thing when you build a business. Does it have the loudspeaker or not? Because a lot of them do, and then a lot of them don't. And I don't know why the gay bookstore needs a PA system.
Well, we just call employees if we don't see them on camera, or you know, sometimes if a customer's parked in the wrong place. Because they don't play with the parking tickets over here.
I understand the
you
guys.
You definitely don't
want to
get called for a cleanup on aisle five.
That is disgusting. How dare you, Dave? All right, so Dante,
yeah,
let me just ask you very quickly.
Hmm?
The guys who come in there at 6 a.m. when you open, do you think they've been up all night, or do you think they're heading off to work?
It's pretty much half and half with that.
Really?
Sometimes, you know, it's just people going to work in the morning, coming by to, you know, grab a paper, some magazines, and something to drink, because we have candy and sodas here, too, or some cigarettes.
Right.
But sometimes you can still see the stamps on their hand from the night before.
Interesting.
I know, you know they haven't been sleeping.
It's an interesting, interesting sleuthing there. All right, Dante. I like you.
Have they? Has anybody hit on you in there?
Of course.
Really? Mm-hmm.
Hey, is the May Colt Roundup out yet?
The what?
You know what I'm talking about, Colt Roundup?
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay, well, if the May one comes in, put it aside. Let's go like hotcakes. All right, buddy.
All right, thanks.
Thanks, Dante. We'll be talking to you soon. That's Dante. Yeah. Runs the counter at the Circus of Books over there in Boys Town. I'll tell you, I've said it many times, but here's how you can, here's why I have no problem with the gays. Actually, I'm a big fan of the gays. You can tell where Boys Town begins because Santa Monica is a horrible stretch of highway. There's Santa Monica, the city, for those of you who are listening outside of Los Angeles. And then there's Santa Monica Boulevard. We do a lot of stupid things over here. We like to name our streets after cities so it can be extra confusing. And then, as if there's not a city named Santa Monica Boulevard and then a street named Santa Monica Boulevard, we also then have to have a little Santa Monica Boulevard so everyone who comes to this town can be horribly confused by the three things named Santa Monica that all reside in the same three-mile area. It's fantastic.
Yeah. Well, particularly Little Santa Monica and Santa Monica Boulevard run right next to one another, parallel to one another.
Smart.
Right next.
Yeah.
Ingenious.
That's just what you want to do. Yeah. That's right. It works. It works like a charm because that way, even if you're born and bred in this city and lived here for 40 years, you can still get lost when you're going over the hill to visit somebody who works on Little Santa Monica as opposed to Santa Monica. But the point is, there really should be a class action lawsuit with the millions of hours wasted, people driving in circles, late, getting fired, not, you know, having business meetings go awry, wasting fossil fuels, just driving in circles on Little Santa Monica. But the point is here's what I like about the gays. You can tell where Boys Town starts by what happens to Santa Monica Boulevard. If you go down to Santa Monica Boulevard in Western, if you go north on Santa Monica Boulevard in Western, or I should say east, and just start making your way down, it's a dive. It's a dump. It's nothing but Mexicans selling oranges and graffiti everywhere and a disaster. And as you slowly move toward Boys Town, it turns into the Yellow Brick Road.
Oh, yeah.
Magically, birds start chirping. They actually pay birds to chirp over there, whereas they just roll around and writhe in pain on the other parts of Santa Monica. All the grass gets green. All of a sudden, it's like walking out of a tenement slum into a beautiful penthouse apartment in Manhattan. That's what the gays do. This is why I have no problem with the gays. All they do is recycle and clean. Go drive through Boys Town. Lawns are like mowed and pristine. You don't see graffiti anywhere.
No litter.
No litter. Only straight guys litter for some reason. And there's never been a gay man alive that's ever done any graffiti, and they certainly don't desecrate anything. They don't vandalize. Little rectum vandalization every once in a while, but that's it. That's as far as they go.
Victimless crime.
That's right. That's what I say. All right, so the next time you have something bad to say about the gays, just go walk through their town, see how they live. What a utopia we'd be living in. It'd be like turning the clock back to the 50s somewhere in the middle of the country.
I
for
live
all the
in
gays.
Boys Town.
You do?
Yes.
You're the mayor.
That's exactly right. Good Christ, no, I'm gay.
They it's beautiful,
me in,
right?
And, yes, and I appreciate it. It's all right. Terrific there.
All right. We will take a break. We're coming back. We're going to do a Passover Seder. Live on the air. Big Tad's got his Biggest Loser update for us. Oh, more tapes from Zacharias Moussaoui. More damning tapes, perhaps. His trial continues. Super smoking hot surfer Anastasia Ashley's coming in here, 19-year-old. Nothing foxier than a fox who does something. Hot blonde chicks who do things. I mean, if you're just a model or an actress, that's hot enough. But if you're a professional athlete, surfer, and you're piping hot?
I don't know that she needs to shame me athletically, though.
Dick Vitale's calling in. Tori Spelling going to be in studio. All that coming up. Bat-10. What grade are we in?
Can't come up with an original one?
It's not the most sophisticated disc.
Is this from Rich? You suck, Rich. Come up with something better.
Sorry, Noel Coward.
Yeah, Oscar Wilde over here.
Not highfalutin enough.
All right.
Don't make me come over there and kick your ass. I'm in a bad mood.
Big Tad in the studio. Big Tad changes the look up a little bit, and I like it. He's wearing glasses. Smart move.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Like a husky porn star scientist. Got a nice goatee going, hat on backward. Big Tad was passed over for the Biggest Loser.
Ales.
And we tried to get him on the show, the Biggest Loser. I blame myself for arguing with those folks from the Biggest Loser. But I sort of, I don't know, A, maybe I have a problem with authority. I hate casting people, number one. I got into it when they came in talking a little about what people were capable of doing. I was explaining that Big Tad had a certain cut that was going to make it difficult, and a genetic hand that was dealt to him that was going to make it difficult for him to lose weight. And they kept arguing back that I was putting Tad down, and they couldn't believe I was trying to dissuade him from going on a diet, which wasn't my aim at all. Do you understand that, Big Tad?
Yes, I do, sir.
Here's all I'm saying. Turn on the TV. This is my point. You can lose weight to a certain extent. But first off, everybody, close your eyes for a second and think about every single goddamn person you know. Do they look any different? I know it's tough. That's why I'm going to give you 3 extra seconds. Okay, everybody. Big Tad, Jimmy Kimmel, his cousin Sal, your wife, your parents, everybody you know, everyone in this room. Some people you've known for a year, some people you've known for 20 years. Does anyone look any different? Has anyone's body shape changed at all? Sure, they fluctuated 8 pounds here and 4 pounds there. Does anyone physically look any different?
No.
No.
Ruska's boobs have gotten bigger.
His areolas have stretched out, but I would say he looks virtually the same.
Otherwise, yeah.
I'm chubby, right, or I'm a lesbian.
Okay, Bruska, please.
Better. I look better.
You'll look better. Actually, you look worse because now we know your personality. It's one of those things where it factors in.
I'm sorry.
All right, here's my point. My point is Big Tad is Big Tad. I met Big Tad when Big Tad was 19. Big Tad looked exactly the same, minus the retarded tattoos.
How dare you?
Point is, by the way, I don't know if that ink adds any weight, but if I was had a weight issue, I would not be sticking extra things. Earrings, tats, you know. A lot of fat guys. A lot of earrings, goatees, tats, piercings, stuff like that. And I could add up.
Get some tattoos of some vertical stripes. That might have a thinning effect.
That's a good idea. That's right. Nice hourglass.
You're on top of the list there, pal.
All right. The point is, yes, Big Tad is going to enter this workplace with a shotgun.
His grocery list.
Yeah. My last words I realize are going to be, get Damashek before I hear a shotgun blast. I do know that I will pass because I've worked with so many people and made fun of so many people that my last words are going to be explaining that I was kidding about whatever what I called them before I hear the Menendez-style shotgun blast. But the point is everyone's exactly the same, and that's what I was saying. Big Tad has Big Tad's metabolism. Mm-hmm. Well, there's a good name.
Write that down.
And it's a bad one. Now, it's good as far as nature goes because you eat an acorn, you put on 5 pounds, and you can live in the wild for another week, whereas Jessica Alba's going to be dead. You see what I'm saying? And I will be on top of her lifeless corpse. But the point is, not having sex with her, you pigs. trying to resuscitate her. The point is you turn on American Idol, you see Mandiza, right? I mean, her ass is like a shelf. It really is. You could put a tray on it.
Put a platter. Serve a buffet on it.
Right. And then there's Eva Longoria. Do you think Eva Longoria looks the way Eva Longoria looks because she works out and has such a strict health routine? As a matter of fact, big people oftentimes eat better because they're constantly dieting and constantly doing battle with. They can't do it. Now, you can have surgery or you can exist off of a pad of butter and a sprig of parsley a day, and yes, of course you will eventually lose weight if you don't eat anything, but the reason most big people can't lose weight is because they want to live the life that we're all living. When somebody drops off the donuts, when somebody drops off the pizza, they want to have a piece too, and their metabolism won't let them. So what I was saying is Tad, you are going to have to work overtime versus Bill over here, the board op, probably being ravaged by Hep C as we speak. I don't know why he stays so thin, but the thing is...
I don't eat.
You don't eat.
I don't eat lunch. I just keep my mouth closed. I'm working. I'm doing other stuff.
I know you open your mouth for at least one thing.
I don't swallow.
All right.
Come on.
You mean the food, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's the whole thing. It's like guys with big calves. You say, wow, look at those big, defined, muscular calves. And they go, I used to dance when I was in the eighth grade. And you go, well, that's not why you have those big calves. Like, you missing lunch isn't why you're you and Big Tad's Big Tad. Your metabolism is why you're you and Big Tad is Big Tad. And what I'm trying to do is give big people a break. I'm just trying to cut them some slack. Yes, Tad?
Yeah. All right. I believe every word you're saying.
All right.
But you're enabling him to do... Like, I understand what you're saying about nature and metabolism and everything. It doesn't help that he's going through the value menu at Wendy's, then Burger King, then KFC lunch.
You ever been to Burger King in that menu? You can get a lot of stuff that's really good.
There's my point. He eats fast food constantly.
Right.
Well, if you would have seen my videotape, you should see all the fast food joints around my house. Everywhere, you know, I get off the freeway, there's a Taco Bell, there's a Burger King.
Yeah.
You know,
I hear what you're saying, Ace. I agree with you to an extent, but Tad's not helping the case.
No, it is definitely a combination. Big Tad is not helping his cause, but I would say if you were flea from the Red Hot Chili Peppers, you just eat whatever you want and you have a six-pack all the time. That is your metabolism. The people we know who are skinny, and we worked with them over at Kimmel, some guys at the writer's table are fat. Some guys are skinny. It's like blaming a guy for being bald when he's 23. Sorry, phone screener Brian. But the guys who are skinny ate the same thing for lunch as everybody else at the table, and they ate just as much, maybe more, just because the heavier guys were sort of watching their calories. Tad, your grandmother wants to chime in on this one.
Hi, I'm the grandma. I'm the oldest of the bunch, and they better all straighten up.
What should they pick me, Grandma?
Oh, yes, definitely. Great loser.
Wait.
What year is she calling in from, by the way?
Well, you need to be there.
Okay, biggest loser.
There you go.
She sounds like one of the Waltons from the turn of the century.
No. Never a loser. Just the biggest loser.
Tab, was she holding a bowl and stirring it during this time?
Churning butter.
It sounded like she was churning or doing something. All right. So anyway, Tad didn't make it on to The Biggest Loser.
It wasn't actually the producer and the casting director at the show. It was the head honchos at NBC that they sent the tape to. They were like, you know, basically you're not fat enough.
Really?
We're going to keep your tape, and hopefully we'll call you next season.
It is one of the perks of running a show about fat people, which is normally it's a little rough whether you're telling someone they didn't get the part or you're breaking up with them. You have to do that thing where it's not, you know, you were great, you were fantastic, it's just, it's not, you didn't make the cut.
That's what I heard.
Always tough. Yeah, but saying you're not fat enough always makes imagine if you could use that. Imagine if me and Teresa were dating and we'd gone out for like 6 weeks and I was like, T?
Yeah.
Thanks for meeting me over at the Olive Garden, by the way.
No problem.
Hey, man, the sex is great. Oh. Sorry for not reciprocating.
It's okay.
Hey, man, I think your family's fantastic. I mean, you're smart. I mean, funny. No, not to me, but other people say you're funny. I just feel like we kind of have to go our own way, you know? I just feel like it's not working out.
Well, why?
You're not fat enough.
But you don't understand. I could get fat. I could eat.
I've heard it before.
No, give me a chance.
Look, you barely finished your garlic bread.
I could get, you know? I could eat more, I could order another pasta, I could stop running, I could stop the Pilates. Just give me a chance, please.
I don't want to remember you trying to get fat verbally. Some guy will like you for the way you are. I just need a fatter broad. I'm sorry, just not fat enough.
It's okay.
Let's part ways. But remember, it's not you, it's me. I don't like you. I always wanted the balls to say that to somebody. No, but the point is you could go home and hold your head up high. That's my point.
Right, it gives you dignity.
Your girlfriend's calling you up. What happened with Adam? Said I wasn't fat enough. Okay, all right, all right. It's a point. I'm just saying, Tad, things could be a lot worse.
Fat, drunk, stupid is no way to go through life.
At least you got your sense of humor. All right, well, the point is Tad, you've moved up the chain over here at the radio station.
Yeah, I'm very happy.
And yes, I do agree with Damashek. Oftentimes, it's a combination. You have the metabolism, and you eat poorly. But here's all I'm saying. It's like when you have your metabolism, it is sort of a handicap. It's like being diabetic or something. You can't just join in and eat the brownies and drink the high C with the rest of the kids at summer camp. You have to eat an apple or whatever the equivalent of it is. It's a lifelong thing. Like anything, it's manageable. You just have to work a little harder than some of the people that don't have your metabolism. And I think a lot of the heavy people don't want to work harder, thus they're heavy, thus they get labeled lazy and, low self-esteem and so on and so forth. So, Tad,
me.
I feel, though, that your larger point that needs to be remembered from this is, because I just reprimanded a couple of girls who work here yesterday. I said, listen, when a poor dope hits on you, don't say, no, I'm not interested in you like that. I don't find you attractive like that. When somebody hits on you in a bar or you know them or whatever, your correct answer is, I'm sorry, I'm seeing somebody. You just say, I'm secretly seeing someone. If you work with them, I don't want anyone to know about it, but I'm seeing somebody. That's a good answer. And now even better to maintain your dignity. I'm sorry, I would date you, but you're not fat enough.
Yes.
I like that.
Or your teeth aren't yellow enough or your nose isn't big enough.
Yes, you walk away with your chin high.
Yes, your multiple chins held up high
don't have
to the
enough
sky.
Chins, yes.
That's
your
right.
Your shoulders are too broad for me and you're a little too tall. I'm
like
sorry.
That.
Yes, you're too narrow at the hip and too broad at the shoulder.
It's not going to work.
You want to go out?
The cleft in your chin is too deep. Your dork displaced too much water during my testing, and I'm sorry. I had to have you do that into that graduated beaker. All right. All right, Tad?
Yes, sir.
Be off.
All right.
All right, thank you, buddy. Like I said.
Go on, get.
The head up. If you are wise, you'll listen to me. Ron?
Yeah.
You had gastric bypass surgery and lost 300 pounds?
Yes, sir, I did. Tad's never going to lose the weight doing what he's doing. He just needs to come to the realization to get the gastric bypass.
Well, here's the thing. I had a friend of mine who was very heavy set the whole time I've known him, and I've known him since he was 25 till he was 40. Then I lost touch with him for a year, had the gastric bypass, and the next time I saw him, he was 180 pounds. You lose. It's bizarre, by the way. It's great for you. You look great in your trunks. You can go out. You can walk again. For it is an assault on everyone else who knows you.
Yeah.
When fat guys get really, picture Big Tad walking in here at 178 pounds. Your tongue would fall out. Your eyes would bulge. Smoke would start coming out of your ears. It is bizarre. It is like rising from the dead. But you, what was your maximum weight, Ron?
I was at 640.
Oh wow.
Whoa.
Okay, but yeah. But he is 5'11 and a half, so.
Right. It's proportional.
Yeah. How tall are you, Ron?
About 6'1".
Okay. And you were heavy your whole life?
Yeah, my whole life.
That's the other thing these retard, by the way, these retard workout, holier-than-thou workout gurus do, is they do that thing where it's like, you see, he was always heavy. You see, they use that as an argument in their behalf. Yeah, he was 2 years old, and he was 30 pounds heavier than everyone else. What was he doing, just doubling up on the strained peas? Just driving himself through Wendy's? Yes.
Well, when I was a kid, they had the, where he, you know, the kids always went off the wall, and they gave him some type of medicine to calm him down. Mm-hmm. Just sit in front of a TV and eat Twinkies all day.
Yeah.
And, you know, parents were happy with that back then.
Yeah, but you were fat and would have been fat anyway. That's what I'm saying.
Oh, yeah.
There's kids that are rail skinny, and they just are, no matter they eat junk. All kids, and by the way, all kids eat junk. That's what you do. It starts catching up to you at a certain point, but it doesn't catch up to you.
Well, but now that he's had the gastric bypass, as you point out, now he looks like, as opposed to a pumpkin, he now looks like a rotten pumpkin. That disgusting looking, you know, when it shrivels
the
all
skin,
up.
The skin
and
does kind of,
because
all the skin that was there just...
It's not good.
Yes. You were 640, you lost 300, so now you're 340.
Correct, 340 right now.
All right, and
my brother weighs 160 pounds, figure.
You still have some time to go, then you're trying to take off another 100 pounds or something?
Yeah, I'm trying to get down to about 250.
But the point is minus the gastric bypass, you would have never lost the weight.
No, I would have probably ballooned up a little more.
All right.
Fair enough, until my deathbed.
How old are you, Ron?
36.
How about the ladies? Have you had any success?
Well, if my wife's not listening, yeah.
Really? And your wife married you when you were how heavy?
I was in the 6 range. Yeah.
Really?
Six range. Yeah.
What size is she?
She's skinny. She's 150 at best, I think.
Wow.
That's skinny for me. So.
Yeah. I would keep my eye on her and you too as a couple, because there's a reason why she hooked up with a guy like yourself in the sixes, and when you remove that, hence removing the weight, there are going to be issues that arise.
Hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, I understand what you're saying.
All right, keep an eye on her.
Keep my walk down.
All right,
great show, by the way.
Thank you. Saw a guy jogging, by the way, yesterday. I was driving down Mulholland. At about 2 in the afternoon, and there was a guy jogging down Mulholland Highway. He had formerly lost 150 pounds, and he had his shirt off. And I'm talking man boobs a-flying. Mm. Gut on him, but when the boobs come out to a point, you know what the breasts of an overweight 13-year-old teenage girl looks like? Maybe a 12-year-old?
I don't know why you do.
Hold on. I didn't say taste like.
I'm sorry.
Although I was thinking that and I corrected myself at the last second. That pointy, fatty, sort of prepubescent girl boob that's always a little bit weird. It's always weird when your friend's daughters are starting to sprout and it's like they come in, a little... Cheryl's really, she's grown up, but she's 11 and a half or 12, but there's just weird little pre-bumps there, weird pointy, and it's awkward. This guy was running with the pointy, had lost 150-pound man boobs, But again, it was warm yesterday. The sun was out. It was 82. How much does a t-shirt really slow you down? I kind of like it. It wicks up the sweat. But at what point does it get so hot that you actually have to? And then how far are you from just going nude at this point? Because according to your logic, these shorts must really be heating you up as well. So he's just happily jogging down the street with the boobs flopping. And I wanted to pull over and start screaming at him, but I scared he was going to squirt me with milk. But I thought, really, this is fine. Chick with an 8-cup, you know, takes her top off at the beach. She's going to get a citation. But Mr. Huge C-cup man boob guy with the pointy man boobs.
Bobby.
Jogging down.
Hey,
Mulholland.
Listen, I don't care if you're built like Laird Hamilton. Keep your shirt on when you're out jogging.
For the love of Christ.
Either way.
I know. Goddamn shirt on.
You're trying to impress the drivers in the cars.
Start jogging on the other side of the street so at least I'll be coming up looking at your ugly back and not running right into the man boobs. All right. Sorry we ran late. Big Tan?
Yes, sir.
The more you know.
Thank you.
I swear to Christ, guys. I see guys all the time. It's 60 degrees. The shirt's off. The shirt's off in the stadium. By the way, the difference between what you smell like when you're sitting at the seat next to me at Dodger Stadium with your shirt off versus the guys wearing a long sleeve shirt or a cotton shirt. You know, when you take your shirt off, you smell. You get home after work, you pull your shirt off over your head and you get a little, ooh.
Spicy.
Yeah, drink too much coffee or something. Yeah, you get that thing. Really? I got to get that from you? And by the way, when the guy sitting next to you at the ballpark has his shirt off, oh, he's a good 4.5 inches away from you. I mean, it's not like he's 4 feet from you. He's sitting next to you with his shirt off, and you're smelling his deodorant. You're seeing the sweat. I mean, well, how about it? We live in a society where you can't, you know, we cut the beer off. You know, I can't go see a Dodger game, bring a six-pack in. Oh, I like Ankerstein. This is my brew. I'll be bringing this in. No, I would be tackled. I would be tackled at the gate. You can't go through the airport without taking your shoes off. We have nothing but rules. How about keep the goddamn shirt on?
And while we're at it, let's do away. Fellas, stop wearing your slippers out. You're not women. Women wear their sandals
right,
out. That's
right.
What men
do. Hold on. Now, that's a cultural thing. You've become racist now. You know what I'm talking about.
I do.
Yeah. You know, the Jews.
Yeah. Be a little sensitive.
Yeah, be sensitive.
I don't want to
see
Passover. I don't want to see men's filthy, hairy, stinking feet.
How?
Women.
How are these folks
going
to buy their lottery tickets if you keep them indoors? A lot of them don't have shoes. They only have house shoes, as they call them. We're going to take a break. All right, we have the whole Passover thing coming up. We're going to do a Seder. Also, more news from Zacharias Massaoui. He did even more damage on the stand.
Oh, no.
Yeah, we're going to hear that after this.
Aloha, this is Laird Hamilton. You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show.
All right, that song hurts my teeth, Bill. Gay board op, Bill. Pre-op. Board op, Bill. Pull that.
This is a Soundgarden Jesus Christ pose.
Well, whatever it is.
Passover.
It's hurting my teeth.
All right, sorry.
All right, we're not as hip as you are, you and your gay buddies. Gary Greenberg is here. Gary's a dear, dear, dear friend. You may be able to tell by the Greenberg that he's Jewish. He's a writer over at Jimmy Kimmel Live. He's got a book out called Be Prepared, a practical handbook for new dads. He's a comedian, but first, he's a Jew, and we decided to talk about the Passover celebration with Gary, who's going to perform the Seder as well. Gary?
Hey, Adam, how you doing?
Good to see you, buddy.
Good to see you, too.
No sweeter man on the face of the earth than Gary.
God,
he's a delight.
Bless you.
God, yes, yes.
Happy Pesach.
Yeah. Happy Pesach to you and yours.
Yes, a mensch and a sea of divas over there at Kimmel. A mensch has arisen, and it's Gary Greenberg. God love you, buddy.
I love you, too.
All right, so I'm sort of an honorary Jew because I have the Jew fro, and I'm named Adam, and I have the nappy brow. I swung a hammer, though, I was never mistaken for a Jew. The second I got into comedy, everyone assumed I was Jewish. You know, they will decide what you are depending on what you do. People stereotype.
Nah, Gary could swing a hammer. No one would confuse him for anything but a Jew.
Yeah, that's true.
No chance.
I'm gonna have to agree with that.
Yes, other people hit themselves on the thumb. He hits himself in the nose. Okay, I'm talking about with the hammer. Now, Gary,
yes.
You're going to perform this Seder for us. But
yes,
tell us, first give us a little history on Passover.
Well, the Jews, we were the original slaves.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. We built the pyramids. I don't know if you know that.
Yes.
We built the Sphinx.
Yes.
Stonehenge.
Oh, did you do Stonehenge?
We did Stonehenge.
Really? Is that factual?
Yeah, yeah. We did a lot of different things.
You did Grand Canyon, too?
We did Grand Canyon, yeah.
Wow.
That's good work.
That was dug by hand.
Absolutely, yeah. Oh, yeah. What do you think? What did you think?
I don't know. I just assumed it was, plate tectonics or something, or had been eroded by the Colorado River. I didn't know the Jews actually physically dug it.
You underestimate the Jews.
Wow.
That's what I'm thinking.
Wow. All right, so you guys did Stonehenge. You did the Grand Canyon.
That's right. It was all slave labor.
98% of the movies.
98%. Yeah, we did that. Right.
Sandy Koufax.
Started Hollywood.
A lot of disease cures.
Certainly. It's tax time.
Yeah. Who's your buddy?
Absolutely.
It's time to start kissing up to the Jews. It's tax time. All right, so Passover celebrates what?
Well, it celebrates our being free from Egypt.
Uh-huh.
We were slaves in Egypt, and Passover celebrates the fact that now we're free. And basically, the entire ceremony of Passover, it reminds us of how horrible we had it. And everything we eat is sort of to torture us.
So you have like bitter herbs and roasted eggs and stuff.
Roasted eggs and gefilte fish and just things that you would never eat in any other time. And matzah itself is just a horribly tasting, binding, constipation-inducing.
It is like just tearing off a piece of cardboard from the box that it came in and eating that. But if you slather enough peanut butter or enough butter, you put the sprinkled cheese on it and toast it and stuff, it can be good. It's just you have to do things to it.
That's right, yeah.
That's what the Jews do. They do the same thing with the liver. The Jews are weird that way. Pardon me for talking about the Jews like you're not here, but the thing that's weird about Jews, Dave and I have spoken about this many a time because that's his heritage. The Jews I find to be sort of a squeamish people. Now, I don't mean that in an insulting way, but I have Gentile friends, and I'll go over there and blow a booger on that guy, and they'll gladly go do it. The Jews will be like, are you high? I'm not going to do that. You know, the Jews, you wouldn't say, drink this. I whipped it up myself. They would sniff it and go, what's in it? Whereas the Gentiles would just shotgun it or get a beer bong out and do it. But the Jews eat parts of animals that I didn't even know was on the animal. They're eating like lobes and hearts and lungs and tongues.
You know kishkas?
Oh, sure, I know
kishkas. Right, you eat that. What is that?
Well, it's intestines stuffed with more intestines.
Yeah, my grandfather was a Hungarian Jew, and he'd come home and be like, great news. What happened? A cow died on the train tracks, and I was able to get its kidneys, lungs, heart, and part of its lower intestine. This is awesome.
Well, tongue is a great... My mom used to just, like, have a giant cow's tongue sitting in a pot boiling. Just a giant tongue.
I know, and that's...
It really is grotesque.
See the taste buds.
Yeah, like, we like some steak and some flank and some whatever, but we're some ribs, but that's where the goyim stops. We're not getting into the tongues and the lungs and the hearts and the organs and stuff.
Yeah.
All right. We need to take ourselves a quick break. When we come back, you will perform... The Seder for us, yes?
I will do a mini Seder.
Thank you. We'll take a quick break. Also, we'll hear the Masawi thing, I believe. We're supposed to play at the top of that break when we come back.
It's time now for free advice from heavyweight champion James Lights Out Tony.
Dear James Tony, I am a 12-year-old boy and I'm having girl problems. There's a girl in my class, Tara, who likes me. I like Tara as a friend. She's asked me out a few times and I said no. I can't date until I'm 16. In the meantime, I like a girl named Amber, who goes to the same school. I've been told Amber likes me. I'd like to ask Amber out, but I don't want to hurt Tara's feelings. What should I do? Torn in Albany, California.
Dear Torn, I respect the fact that you are a sensitive young man with a conscience. If you intend to ask Amber out anytime soon, you should first chat with Tara and explain that you weren't entirely truthful with her regarding your parents' restriction on dating. Tell her you like her as a friend. Hope you will always be friends, but you will not be comfortable dating her. At least not right now, excuse me. This predicament should have taught you that even a small lie can assume gigantic proportions, even bite you in the fanny.
Free advice from heavyweight champion James Lights Out Tony.
Mm-hmm.
Fists of iron, heart of gold.
Yeah, good man. I'm assuming he's a Jew.
Oh, a lot of heavyweight champions.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Well, no, the Jews are always quick to point out Gary Lights Out Greenberg here. He's, we have Dave Damashek, but he's a Jew who's lost his rudder. He doesn't know Passover from Christmas. He really doesn't.
I was just a bar mitzvah, though. I became a man when I was 13.
He's technically a Jew, but he's of no Jew purpose to us. He doesn't know anything about the holidays or how it works, the rituals. You're going to tell us about the Seder. But we're talking about the Jews building the pyramids, you know, original slaves. Also, original boxers. A lot of them boxing when they came to this country, turn of the century, into the 20s and 30s. Here's the point to all other cultures. They helped each other out. They stepped up. Now, they don't do any more schlepping, and they don't do any more punching. That's how it works. You guys, you non-Jews out there that are tired of schlepping and tired of getting smacked in the head, do what the Jews do. Hang together. Keep the family together. Look out for your own. Pretty soon, you'll not be schlepping or punching. Thank you. The more you know. Thank you. All right, Gary.
Okay.
Whose schlepping days are long gone.
Yep.
It's Seder time. Seder time.
Absolutely. And we have a Seder plate right in the middle of the table here.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just going to go through some of the items on it. There's the generic vegetable, which is cucumbers.
Mm-hmm.
We got bitter herbs to remind us of our bitter times under slavery. We have the horosis, which is a mixture of nuts, dates, apples, wine, and cinnamon. We have a lamb shank bone.
What's the horosis stand for?
The mortar that they used to build the temple. It's the mortar.
Was made of dates and raisins?
Yeah, well.
That's why it didn't stand.
It didn't really,
It was a wasteful time.
All right.
Yeah, that's why we're not really.
They didn't have lime and Portland cement back then, huh? All right.
And,
Gary says that's why the Jewish people aren't in the construction business.
Yes. Yeah. What happened? I hired a Jew to build me a barbecue. Yeah. What happened? It rained.
Yeah.
And then all I got was applesauce.
Date shake.
I got a date shake out of it.
Gefilte the fish. It's an igloo. Okay, so we have the lamb shank bone.
Yeah, what's that for?
Well, yeah, you know, that's sort of conflicted. Some people say it's the lamb, the blood of the lamb was the thing that the Jewish people put on the top of their doors so that God would know not to slay the firstborn of the Jews,
right,
but slay the firstborn of the Egyptians.
And in turn, he would pass over
that. He would pass
that
over.
House.
There
exactly.
You go.
Right.
Yeah. But others say something different.
Mm-hmm.
That's good. So we got it. And then we have roasted eggs, but for some reason you guys picked Easter eggs, which is completely blasphemous.
Well,
I have a good mind to walk out.
That's Bruska. He's not only a Gentile, but a husky lesbian, so you can't ask
him
to
shop
for Passover.
Don't blame anyone else, Gary. Gary got all this stuff at Wailing Walmart.
Okay. So, first thing we do is we pour the cups of wine. You guys got your cups of wine there?
Sure.
And we have an extra cup for Elijah.
Right.
My favorite part.
Elijah is the greatest. Elijah is this invisible prophet who you pour, you have to leave your door open for him.
Mm-hmm.
Even though he's invisible and he's a prophet, I guess he can't manipulate a deadbolt.
Mm-hmm.
So you got to leave your door open for him.
Right.
And if you're lucky, he comes in and he drinks your wine and he leaves.
Yeah.
So you got to leave. It's almost like a weird sort of Santa Claus.
Yeah.
You know, you leave milk and cookies for Santa Claus. Except Santa Claus, like, brings you good stuff. I mean,
right, this guy
Elijah
just takes a swig off your booze and then splits,
yeah,
right?
He's like a horrible party guest.
And instead of eating cookies, you leave macaroons.
No.
Gail, Brusker, are you going to get the door?
How's Elijah going to get
door?
In?
How's Elijah going
to
get
You're
in?
You're supposed to leave him a chair open, too, right?
Yeah, you leave a chair for Elijah, right?
Yeah,
you got to
leave a chair for Elijah.
All right.
But the guy really doesn't show. And if he does, he portends the doom of humanity. So even if he does show up, it's not good. So then we say the blessing over the wine, which is, blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine.
Wow.
Everybody drink.
That is horrible.
It's Manischewitz.
Oh.
Yeah, Manischewitz, it's the only wine you can pour out onto wax paper and make fruit roll-ups. You know, I always was wondering where Manischewitz came from, and I once followed the Manischewitz truck all the way back to the Robitussin plant.
Oh, really?
Yeah. That's why they have the little cup on the top of the Robitussin. It's for Elijah.
That yeah. Yeah.
So, okay, we got that. Now we got to wash our hands. Everybody, we have a bowl, and everybody like wash their hands.
All right, we'll symbolically do that. Right.
And we got to dip a vegetable. Everybody, take a little cucumber there, and we'll dip the old vegetable in the salt water.
Mm-hmm.
And we do that.
When you eat, what do you actually eat?
There's
a time when the brisket's going to come out at some point, right?
Yeah, that's after you've filled up on matzah and
haroses.
Right.
And horseradish. At the end, you get to eat regular food.
By the way, you dip it in the salt water because that represents what?
Represents the tears that your ancestors shed.
Drinking the Manischewitz. Drinking this god-awful Manischewitz. How about, let me tell you something. The Goyim would be like, look, let's just kick each other in the nuts real fast, get it over with, and then we can start noshing. You know what I mean? Why all the bitter herbs and the roasted this and the horrible wine? Why don't you guys just smack yourself? Just make a fist, punch yourself in the face just one time, and now we can eat.
That's a good idea.
Just sort of expedite the whole thing. Yeah. There's the pain of our Jews gone by. Now let's eat.
I'll bring that up to my
rabbi.
Bring
that up to your rabbi, please.
Okay, now we have the four questions. I think all of you have your sheets there.
Yes.
Okay. Do you want to go around the room? We want to do this.
All right. Okay. Well, I'll answer to number one, Gemini.
This is the best thing is that is the best part of the Passover Seder is that you go around the room and everybody reads.
All right.
It's fun.
So should I read the first one?
Yeah.
Why is this night different from all other nights?
Okay. And then read the second one.
Oh, I read them all. I see. On all other nights, we eat bread and matzah. On this night, only matzah. Wow. Talk about a departure. So it'd be like if on every night you ate meatballs and spaghetti, but this night we only eat spaghetti. Woo! I don't know if I'm ready for that kind of change. Hold on, let me strap in. All right, keep going. Dave, read the next two.
Well, these are the rest of the answers. On all other nights, we eat all types of herbs. On this night, only bitter herbs.
Oh, I'll tell you. You want to talk about G-force. I don't know if your body could handle that.
And lastly, how is this night different from the rest? On all other nights, we do not dip even one time. On this night, two times.
I couldn't handle the multiple dipping.
Okay.
From one to this. Also, there should be a fifth one, which is normally we don't ask these stupid questions.
That's true.
Tell your rabbi that when you're punching him.
Adam, this is not good. Adam's trying, Gary, by the way, Adam is seeking a religion for his unborn twins, So Judaism right now is the front runner.
Passover's not a great holiday to show off how great Judaism
is. No, Purim is really the
day.
Purim's a good one. Hanukkah or something. Passover's really not the good one. And speaking of that, do you want to do the plagues? Do we have time to do the plagues?
Yeah, fart them out, but let's take this home, Shlomo.
Okay. we have the foxiest woman on the globe sitting about 15 feet away in the green room talking to Fat Tad. Beautiful blonde Anastasia Ashley.
Yes.
And we're sitting in here with Gary doing the Passover.
That's right. And we're not leaving until it's over.
Let me do some quick Jew math on her. Anastasia Ashley, 19, blonde, foxy, professional surfer. You think she's celebrating the Passover tonight from Orange County?
Up in the air. Too soon
to
judge.
It's a coin toss. Yeah, we'll have to find out. See if she's wearing a chai, Tad. All right, sorry. Go ahead,
Okay,
Gary.
Okay. You got to dip your finger in the wine, and you got to recite all the plagues that befell the Egyptians that didn't befall the Jews.
All right.
Okay, ready? Number one, blood.
Mm-hmm. Blood.
Blood.
Frogs.
Frogs. Frogs.
Lice.
Lice.
Wild beasts.
Wild
beasts.
It's
like camp.
Pestilence.
Pestilence.
Boils.
Boils.
Hail.
Hail.
Hail. Locusts.
Locusts.
Darkness.
Darkness.
And the number one plague, slaying of the firstborn.
Wow.
Seems like darkness isn't that bad compared to the other ones.
Well, considering it's dark 12 hours out of the 24 hours we're alive every day. Not such a big one. And frogs, yes, one could argue they're a good time.
Pestilence and wild beasts seem a little bit worse than the frogs.
Yes.
Yeah, they got a bad rap.
Well, not all the plagues are equal.
The guy that wrote the book must have had a frog thing.
Yeah, it must have been weirded out.
Yeah, he's like, It's too running out at 9 doesn't seem right. We got to get it to 10. Ah, frogs.
You pad it with frogs. All right, Gary, thank you very much for performing the Seder with us. Yeah. Gary Greenberg, everyone. You can find his great work on Jimmy Kimmel Live, also on Amazon. Be
nice
prepared.
Job, Gary. L'chaim.
L'chaim yes. to all of you.
Gary's Happy book, Passover. A practical handbook for new dads. And let's do some news. Gary, just hang out with us, please. If you want to write me some jokes, that would be awesome. You know, I know it's your way.
While you're here.
Yeah. Teresa Strasser now is going to do the news.
It's Zacharias Moussaoui's turn in court. The prosecution rested its case yesterday after playing the cockpit recording from doomed United Flight 93 in the courtroom. Today, defense attorneys for Moussaoui will begin arguing that the 9/11 conspirator deserves life in jail rather than the death penalty.
Yeah, misunderstood. We talked about a few weeks back about how he got on the stand and did more damage to himself than any prosecutor could by opening his fat trap and talking about how he was supposed to be on a fifth plane that was going to fly into the White House. And he just sealed his own fate. People know about that part of the story. What they don't know about is he kept going. He offended Americans in ways that I can't even describe. And if he didn't do enough damage with the fifth plane talk, just listen to some of these recordings we got.
I would go to Mount Vernon, dig up the corpse of George Washington, and use his wooden teeth to nibble the buttocks of a male prostitute.
Wow, that any American's going to take offense.
Stovepipe hat.
Is it open at the top?
I wanted to cut the cable to the Golden Gate Bridge and then use them to whip Lee Greenwood. Proud to be an American, my ass.
Wow, well, thank God that's all he said, because this guy really knows how to put his foot in his mouth. What? There's more?
More.
Oh, I can't believe it. Let's hear it.
I will go to Cape Canaveral, steal the original Apollo rocket, drive it...
Okay. As an American,
I wanted to go to Boston and light a beacon in the Old North Church, except instead of a lantern, it would be the skull of Mark Twain.
No, okay, now I've heard enough.
I wanted to reassemble the members of Grand Funk Railroad and make them perform We're an American Band while being electrocuted in their testicles.
That's enough now.
I wanted to steamboat it into the swimsuit competition of the Miss USA
Band. I've heard enough out of this man.
Plan to reenact Benjamin Franklin's famous electricity experiment, except the key would be a baby, and a kite made from the skin of the dog from Frasier.
Oh, all right.
I wanted to go to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, steal Bob Dylan's harmonica, put it in my butt crack, and fart. The times, they are a-changing.
That is enough now.
I would fly to the beaches of Normandy, where the soldiers died on the D-Day. And make a sandcastle where all the towers look suspiciously like penises.
Okay, now I'm sickened by this man.
He's going to fry. That's the only
Well, as I said, if this guy didn't do enough damage with the fifth plane talk, he's sealed his fate
now. You could just tell by those comments and even things he was thinking about. He's a jerk.
He is. Thank God we apprehended him before he acted on any of these things. All right, I'm sorry, Teresa.
That's
go ahead.
Okay. On to entertainment news, or should I say adult entertainment news. Ooh. Hundreds of extremist Muslims trashed a building in Jakarta yesterday that houses the Playboy offices to protest the publication. The Indonesian Playboy is a toned-down version of the magazine and does not feature nudity.
Mm, really?
Yeah, they're
the hell
fully
are they
clothed.
Doing?
Maybe that's why they were protesting.
Yeah. You know, it'd be an interesting thing, save you a lot of time and plastic explosives. If you just go ahead and put just get a big sign printed up that says free American porn and just put it in front of a mosque and then have it destroyed. You know what I mean? Instead of driving a truck bomb into it or dirtying your hands, just get a nice big banner built up, you know, laid out in front of the mosque there, a Playboy sign on it, maybe a Girls Gone Wild thing, and just be immediately taken down to the bare studs. If in fact they even have that, down to the mortar that the Jews use, the snot and the raisins, that'd be a good way to do it. All right.
On one hand,
I don't like the fact that these people attacked our institution known as Playboy. On the other hand, if you're going to call yourself Playboy and not have any boobies, you deserve to be taken down.
Fair enough.
Thank you.
Last night on American Idol, another contestant was eliminated. In the bottom three were Bucky, Ace, and Elliot. And I don't know if you guys remember, but last time I was here, I talked about the internet betting odds. Mm-hmm. They put Bucky at 65-1 with the longest odds. Let's see what happened last night. Ryan Seacrest.
After the vote, leaving us tonight on American Idol is Bucky.
I know you're all very upset.
Yeah.
He's the guy from Real World Los Angeles, right? About 10 years ago?
He's very similar to that guy.
Yes. Not a Jew, by the way.
Bucky? Bucky? No. Covington,
Bucky,
not a Jew.
Bucky the country singer. No.
Yeah. Yeah. Huh. I would say bad things about him, but I ran into him in the halls of NBC or CBS, actually, a week ago, because I was filming this game show thing over there, and all the American Idol folks are there, and they were coming down the hall, and there was Bucky, and there was Ace, and there was Chris, and they were all the nicest, sweetest guys in the world, so I won't say anything horrible. And it was last Thursday, so he was fresh off, not getting cut, feeling confident. Now, bottomed out.
Speaking of bottom, do you want to hear a little bit of his fat bottom girl version?
Sure, sure. Wasn't a bad song for him.
No, I thought he did a great job.
Yeah, I think truthfully Ace probably did the worst job, even though he was a sweet guy when I met him last week, but I really do think his looks are carrying him.
Yeah, he doesn't have longer. He's short-timing in that competition.
And once again, let me say, if you are a grown-up, if you're an adult, and you make a sign and go to American Idol and hold it up to show support for Ace or Bucky or anyone else, you are officially a humongous loser.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, I didn't use glitter, if it helps.
You didn't use your puffy paint glitter pen?
No, it's just a straight Sharpie, keeping it simple.
Okay, and finally, Muhammad Ali is selling 80% of the marketing rights to his name and image for $50 million to a firm to use for advertising campaigns. That's $50 million.
Wow.
For only 80%.
The greatest of all time.
And how does it work? Because you see his name and likeness on a lot of stuff anyways. He's just doing it. He's doing piecework. He's just saying, you want to use it for this campaign. It's $2 million. But now, who is the firm, by the way? It's a marketing firm. It's not a company.
Firm, yeah.
I think they're going to have the Muhammad Ali George Foreman grill.
That's interesting.
Wow. That could
Man,
be a big
we
seller.
Should get somebody funny in here, like Gary.
Yeah, we should.
Yeah. Is there anything else Ali product related you think, you know, he could market?
Well, now you're putting him on the spot.
But he's so good.
Yeah. All right. Okay. Maybe not so funny.
In 10 minutes, it'll come to you.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that's Muhammad Ali. He's the greatest. I'm not. I'm Teresa Strasser. That's the news.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
From someone funny like Gary to me, unfortunately. And Bruska is giving it to me again with the speed it up and blah, blah, blah,
now
this
you're
and that.
It up.
Listen,
now
I want to. I'm going to be brief because I don't want to do anything to offend the
he
beautiful
to
surfer Anastasia Ashley waiting.
She's
waiting.
Hot. Yeah, Dave, could you just pass over sports?
Yes. Dodgers lost, Clippers won. Good night.
Thank you, Dave.
Number one sports.
All right, I better just for the sake of earning my keep, just quickly say that the Dodgers lost to the Pirates. Arizona, they won. Padres won over Florida. San Francisco Giants rained out for the second straight day, which clearly can only be taken as God is going out of his way to make sure Barry Bonds never plays another game. San Jose Sharks clinched a playoff spot.
Thank you.
Jonathan Chichu and company are on to the next round. And I'll save everything else for the next time. So
all
we can
right,
get,
let me just ask you: do you think with Passover there'll be NBA games tonight?
Well, of course. I mean, you'd have two, three guys. You'd be two
you
on
can't
two.
Field a team. Right.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I mean, you might have a coach, maybe a water boy or something, but none of the guys in the league are going to be able to play.
Skip
they're all
out. You're right.
They're all home. Doing a no-look Passover. The NBA's version of Passover. Come on, write that down, Gary.
I got it. It's going to be on Kimmel
tonight.
It'll
be funny on Kimmel.
I like when people tell you a crappy joke and then explain you can keep it. That's yours. You can have Bonnie Paper Towel and I could keep that as well.
Instead of Dr. J, Dr. Jew, Dr. High.
Okay, that's just not funny.
I'm trying
funny. That's not funny.
All right.
It's offensive. As a man with Jewish hair and sensibilities, I'm offended. Gary Greenberg, Gary Lights Out Greenberg, thank you for coming in.
Thank you for having me.
Nice job with the Jew stuff.
Thanks.
All right, now we will take a break. Young, hot Anastasia Ashley, who is dressed to the nines, by the way, which I appreciate because a lot of people don't doll it up for radio, but this is hot.
And by the way, August and Fat Tad are out there taking their chances with her.
Yes.
Poor girl.
Tad orbiting her like a fat moon. We'll take a quick break. We'll bring a super hot surfer in after this.
It's the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam Carolla now. 866-901-AGAM.
Mm-hmm. Anastasia Ashley. The best female surfer in the world is in studio. Certainly the foxiest. Thank you for coming to the show.
What?
Thank you for having me.
A woman.
Relax.
What a woman.
Observe the Passover by passing over speech. Anastasia is 19, is blonde, is foxy. I'm trying to think who she looks like. Who do people say you look like? Have you gotten that a few times?
I actually get a lot of Jessica Simpson.
Perfect.
Which I think's flattering.
Right, but a professional surfer.
Yeah.
And there's nothing better. You wear a two-piece, right, when you surf?
Of course.
Yeah. Nothing better than seeing a woman in the poised position with the two-piece. You see the shots of them doing the kickbacks or whatever. They're sort of in that half-squat position, legs glistening, tan legs, wet, moist, glistening in the sun, flexed quads. It's a great look. And thank you for dolling yourself up before you came in here.
Of course.
Really?
I knew I was coming to see you.
Really?
Yeah. Oh,
something there. Tell me, let me just say this. Anastasia Carolla.
Yeah, I like it.
That's
exotic.
You
have to be hot with the name Anastasia.
So you do. Right. Carolla evens it out a little bit, but you could do worse. You know what I mean?
I think it fits good.
We hook up. We get a condo down at the beach. Maybe we move across the street from Laird.
Yeah, huh?
And what's her nose over there? Hitting them volleyballs around.
Yeah, Hamilton Reese. And Reese.
Reese, yeah.
Volleyball parties.
Yeah, Gabby Reese and Laird. Every morning, you get up. You make me breakfast, and then you and Laird hit the surf. Laird's dragging a log along the sand, trying to strengthen his muscles. You're out there practicing your Ann Flanders or whatever you guys do, your 180s, your whatever. Me and Gabby just looking at you from over the vista. I'm eating. I ballooned up to 300 pounds by now. It's awesome.
Of course.
Yeah. Did you really get dressed up just to come in here?
I did.
Why?
Of course. Because, you know, I've listened to you and seen you on TV, and for many years, I used to watch Love Line a lot, and,
Wow. Yeah. So you have a little, I mean, I'm a married man, not for long now, but you have that thing, every once in a while, you see some super hot chick with some washed up old actor, and you say, what is that young hot model doing with that old pig? And you realize they saw this guy during their formative years when they were nothing and they were 13 and they were sitting at home. They were watching this guy on whatever crappy sitcom he was on in the 80s or the 90s. They still have that vision in their head.
Yeah, Scott Baio effect.
Right. It just keeps going. So we'll have that.
Yeah, yeah, because that's when I used to watch you when I was like 12, 13.
Yeah, and it was naughty, too. You weren't supposed to stay up and watch MTV.
Yeah, I wasn't allowed, I don't think, to watch, but I always had a TV in my room, so I'd watch.
talking about dirty things, too, listening to Ace talk about it.
Yeah, there was that old guy with the nappy hair talking about stuff. Forbidden fruit. I mean fruit, I mean gay. No. I mean forbidden.
Don't blow this.
All right. You're right.
she's liking you now.
So really, Anastasia, was there an attraction to me?
Yeah, I guess, like, ooh. I always thought you were really funny and, I don't know, just a great personality.
Mm-hmm. So maybe not physically
attractive. I like you better than Dr. Drew.
All right. She's qualifying it now. So. But the point is there could have been, we could have had one of those May-December things. There could have been a love connection,
yeah.
Right?
That could... You know, maybe more.
Wow.
Ooh la la.
I would love just to go to the beach, set up my folding chair, pull up the cooler. just nurse myself a 12-pack and watch you out there surfing.
When are we going?
So you're still open, Anastasia.
Wait a second. Is Anastasia single?
I have a boyfriend.
She can't.
But I think he'd understand, so.
He'd understand because he used to watch MTV, too.
Well, and, you know, his name's Adam, too.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
What's he do? I don't trust him. I don't like him.
He's my replacement for Mr. Corolla for now, so.
Sort of a placeholder. Like, you know when they're doing like the Oscars or the Grammys and the day of practice, the day before the show, they just have the cardboard cut out of the star sitting there.
Yeah, yeah.
This is where Robert Duvall will be.
Yeah.
That's what this guy Adam's doing.
Yeah.
You'll be hanging around until the real Adam gets the divorce and finalizes everything, and then he slides in for the kill.
In the meantime, you're just with cardboard Adam. Right.
Yeah.
But now, what does this character do for a living?
He actually owns a seasoning company called Amazing Taste Foods. They sell it in Ralph's and Albertsons.
I knew it!
you realize you can have any man you desire. You're with the Spice
Family. Yeah, man, hold on
obviously
a second.
He's a nice man.
No, he's very, very handsome.
I got to tell you, if I had a nickel for every time I had some hot, blonde, 19-year-old professional surfer that was into me, and some guy owned a seasoning company got with her, who shared my name, I'd be a rich man. I'm sorry, I'm still smarting over the Lawry's incident. All right. So, Anastasia, by the way, Dave has a question. Not this Dave, but Dave the caller. Dave?
Yeah. Hey, Adam. Love the show.
Thank you.
My question is going to feed into your fantasy a little bit. Anastasia, have you ever surfed naked?
Good question.
No, I haven't, but I've had my top fall off a lot of times when I was surfing, so I don't know if that kind of qualifies.
Not intentionally, but, it would seem like that, you know, I mean, in the white water and the churning water and all that kind of stuff, I mean, you could definitely shoot a winger out there when you're on that surfboard.
Yeah.
And then there's thousands of guys with the long, long lenses sitting on the cliffs, right, that are taking pictures.
Exactly.
Perfect.
So
get on the internet and find that. So what's what's next? I know you have a calendar coming out this summer.
Yeah, I'm going to be coming out with my calendar. It's going to be sold in Barnes & Noble's, Borders, online, everywhere. And right now, too, I'm currently promoting my work with PETA, which is everyone can look at www.peta2.com. And we're doing a cool contest where I actually pick out an outfit for the winners who ever win the sweepstakes.
Really? I work with a group called META, where we actually just eat nothing but meat.
Yeah, well,
meat cereal.
What about Cardboard
Danish.
Adam? Cardboard Adam, though, his whole business is predicated on you.
Well,
you can season
up the
meats. That's what I do. Like, I use it for vegetables and
this thing's not going to work out.
Tofu.
But this guy, this merchant of death, as I know him, this man who does nothing but season flesh so that the man can go on consuming our beloved animals, the cows and the pigs and the chickens. Certainly there has to be a conflict of interest. It's like a Jew dating a Nazi general.
Well, I mean, he doesn't actually go out and, I guess, kill the animals. So I don't really have a problem. I don't really have a problem with people eating meat either. I just personally am a vegetarian.
Okay.
I'm just for people treating the animals good.
Okay. That's it. Because I'll eat ribs for breakfast.
Like if we're
so
out
when
on
we
our
shack up, you're gonna know. You
like
know?
If we're out on our date and you order steak, I mean, I'm not gonna be like, oh
no
my gosh,
yeah.
You know, we can work through this.
Yeah, and it'll just be because I'm trying to get a little iron into my system for the night, night we have ahead. And notice she said out on our date. She didn't say a date. She said our date.
So you get to eat steak, and then later you get to season her tofu.
What the hell does that mean? That is disgusting.
It's titillating, but yet I'm uncomfortable.
Yes. Dave, pass over yourself once again, please. All right, Anastasia, so many things to talk to you about. Also, I want to ask about Bethany, who you're friend with, the surfer that got her arm bit off.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Were you guys friends before she got her arm bit off?
Yeah. She and I surfed against each other. I had known her for probably a couple years. She's been around for a while, and it was quite a bummer when I heard she got her arm bit off.
Does it freak you out?
Definitely. Like, I never really thought that was a possibility before that happened, because you hear things, but you don't ever know it's mm-hmm. someone you actually know.
Right.
So, yeah, ever since then, it's been a lot.
I've heard a lot of surfers interviewed that have been attacked by sharks, and they always say two things. One, they don't blame the shark. My thing would be, not only do I blame the shark, I will put a bounty out on its, bring me its dorsal fin. I'm going to kill this shark.
I'd blame the shark.
But no, you would blame the shark, yeah. Right. And then number two, they're getting right back into the water. As soon as the doctor pulls the staples out of their side, they're going right back in. I guess their logic is, how could I get bit twice by a shark?
I guess. I mean, I think it's kind of rare to even see a shark, but, so I guess that's what it is. Once you, I guess, if you were to get bit, it's bad luck to get bit again.
I guess it's like getting hit by lightning twice, right. but you do hear about it. And then I can't figure out what's up with sharks because they always explain they don't know who you are. They think you're their favorite food, which is a seal.
Yeah.
But the
I don't
seal
think I look like a seal.
No, not
a
with
really
them.
Hot seal.
Yeah, you look like a smoking hot blonde porn seal. Porn seal.
What's that?
No porn.
I don't know, but I'd like to close my envelopes with it.
Make it into a jacket.
Porn seal. I'll put my porn seal on. My point is sharks can taste a drop of blood in 7 million gallons of salt water. How are they mistaken a hot, lanky blonde who's on a 6-foot surfboard with a 40-pound seal? I don't know how that works.
Hey, Anastasia, I'll show you a 40-pound seal.
All right. That's enough
I'm
out
sorry.
Of you.
Sorry. That's...
Let's just start planning our date, Anastasia. Let's take a break and let's hammer out some of the beats, you know?
I'll hammer you out, Anastasia.
I'm going to need you to pick me up early, by the way, about 6 o'clock.
Okay.
And, you know, just give a toot on the horn. Don't come to the door. I don't want the old lady getting out of line. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'll give you a toot on the horn.
All right. That's enough. Anastasia Ashley is in studio. PETA2.com is where you go to find out more information about her latest goings-on. Also, Celebrity Car Magazine. You have a car? You have a nice car?
I have a few.
Yeah, what do you have, a Woody?
No.
Dave has a
that's
Woody.
Dave, yeah.
Beat me to it.
What are you driving?
I have two Mercedes and a Porsche.
You two are so alike.
I'd love to show you my garage. Better yet, I'll look at yours. Let's take a break.
Okay.
Should find out if my wife's awake. All right, we'll take a break. We'll be back after this.
Big Tad out here on the streets of Hollywood. I'm out here looking for people that I think are crazy. Can you prove to me you're not crazy?
Why I'm not crazy? Because, I understand and know that you are, let's say, somebody that's, how should I say, mature. And if you say that you think I'm crazy, then I agree. And I don't have no questions about not being crazy, so I'll just be crazy.
Fantastic. All right. I think we have about 8 minutes before my wife wakes up, so we have to work quickly with Anastasia Ashley, world's best professional female surfer. Won over 300 surfing events. Oh, what a party. You know, my wife's pregnant with twins right now.
So really? Congratulations.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a boy and a girl or two boys. I can't remember.
They're not here.
Yeah, then they'll never know.
I don't
know.
See him here.
Yeah, here's the pitch. Instead of having the kids really get to know me as a father and then cutting out in 2-3 years and really scarring them, best they should not know me at all. Right. I think that's kind of the thing.
They won't know anything different.
Yeah, Aunt Anastasia. Mm-hmm. You know, we'll give you a title. It's not going to be, you know, be chick du jour, you know what I mean? I mean, you'll have a title. They'll not know who you are.
Yeah, you two are in it for the long haul, I assume.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
And you're just 19, right?
Yeah.
Your best years are ahead of you. My best are behind. That's how it works. You're out there living.
I think your best years are still coming.
Well, it depends who I'm with.
Exactly.
Yeah. So I figure we buy some land up in Malibu Way.
That's nice.
Across from Laird over there.
Yeah.
And like I said, you guys are up at the crack of dawn. You're doing your thing
out
in the ocean.
Your house is bigger than Laird's.
Yeah. Yeah, we got a big big pad.
We got a big estate, huh?
Yeah. I mean, I
have
a pretty sizable income. Of course, I'm going to have to part with half of it, but that's fine. Still enough. We'll live off love. Hey, you know what? We'll be beach bums. We'll be gypsies.
Exactly. We don't need the big Malibu estate.
No.
We can just pitch a tent.
No, all we need is the pup tent that's in my sweatpants and the love that we have. We'll pitch a tent on the sand. It'll be one of those things, you know?
Lean-to in the woods.
That's right.
Yeah. Tad's pitched a tent in his pants.
We'll be living.
By the way, Anastasia has a beautiful outfit on just to paint the picture. Beautiful, long, blonde hair. Skin colored by the sun.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she really is gorgeous. She looks like Tara Reid, but when Tara Reid was really hot.
Yeah, that's
This isn't a sloppy, bloated, drunken Tara Reid.
Right.
This is a
no
young
paradise.
Brown. How do you describe that shirt? It's a brown
halter.
And it plummets down almost to her navel.
Yeah,
exposing
she's 19,
her ample
so her,
bosom.
She doesn't need a
knock it off, damn it, Shaq. Jeez.
Yeah, Big Tad. By the way. Big Tad and our booker, and as I said, nobody books from within the building as well as Mike August does. Number one building booker right here, Mike August. These two were, by the way, Anastasia, between the two of them, and I'm not exaggerating, they have not been laid in over 6 years. I would say seven. Mike has 4 years of celibacy under his belt. Big Tad,
that's cool,
if you could find room under his belt, you would see that there was 2 years of celibacy he had behind him. So between the two of them, they're chomping at the bit, talking your ear off over there in the kitchen. I apologize. Have you guys put together a little limericks for Anastasia?
I have.
You have?
I have as well, yes.
All right, who would like to go first?
I'll let the old man go first.
Oh, all
right. Well, she has a thing for distinguished gentlemen. We've already established that, Tad, so youth may not be working for you.
You're distinguished. I don't know what the hell he is.
All right. You have girth working for you,
yes.
But youth, no.
How dare you?
Go ahead, Mike.
All right. There once was a super hot surfer girl named Anastasia Ashley, who says she finds Dave Damashek quite ghastly.
Mm-hmm.
She surfs all day long, which is why her body's so strong, which is why I love her so vastly.
Mm.
Nice, right? Thank you.
Which is why twice, but you're nice. That was strong.
Respectful. I like it.
I would write you a poem every morning, by the way. up every morning to...
Do you sing at all?
I sing. I write poetry.
You dance.
I dance. I will be playing the acoustic guitar. You'll wake up every morning to the smell, I was going to say of Canadian bacon, but of tofu.
That's great.
Of tofu, bacon. Fresh coffee. I would sing vehicle for you. Fresh pressed orange juice.
Oh, that's good.
Toast, butter, and jelly. Every morning, flour. Put in a vase, a tray, and then me with my acoustic guitar singing vehicle. Or Hell is for Children by Pat Benatar.
When is this all starting, Adam? I mean...
Starting about 10:01 this morning.
Okay.
Just hang tight. Big Tad?
Yes.
You have a limerick?
Yes, I do.
Mm-hmm.
All right, here we go. Anastasia, she is so fine. Oh, how I would like to make her mine. She is from the OC, which is very cool. If you pick August's limerick, you will look like a fool. Pick me, and I'll show you a good time. This is the end of my love rhyme.
Mm-hmm.
That's retarded.
Hey, wait. You know what? You gave him a big clap, and you give me the little one?
It didn't work. It's retarded.
I don't give a rat's ass what you think.
All
it's
right.
What she thinks.
Look. Neither one of you has a shot.
I know I don't have a shot.
I'm already taken, guys.
Yeah, that's right. By the Ace Man.
Yeah. I can't beat the Ace Man.
Yeah. You tell Mr.
But I know I can beat him, though.
Tell Mr. Paprika that there's a new seasoning sheriff in town, and his name is Ace, all right?
Okay.
He'll understand.
Do you need me to take someone out?
Yeah.
Ace Man?
Yeah.
All right.
Yes, tell him.
Take yourself out the door, please.
Yes. Tell him to take his nutmeg and his cinnamon sticks and hit the bricks. That'd be good. When you dump him, yell different spices at him and tell him to pack it up and hit the road. All right. Is he rich at least? Does he make a lot of money?
Yeah, I mean, they do really well.
Oh, family business. Had to go in with daddy. Didn't have the courage to strike out on his own and clean carpets like me.
He's only 22, so.
Ah, kid. Nah. Yeah, you need a man. You need a boy in there.
Are you going to be that man?
Yes. I will teach you.
I think we already discussed this. We are. You've already agreed. So
yes.
What am I talking about?
I will teach you everything I've learned over the years. And we'll hit you with a renewed sense of commitment and vigor.
But would you give up meat? I mean, she is a PETA spokesperson.
But that's the beauty of our relationship. We don't judge. We love. You have your surfboards and your PETA.
You have your mic.
I have my microphone. I have my Canadian bacon.
Your unibrow.
My unibrow, my TiVo.
It's okay, we can wax that.
That's the beauty.
Yeah, there you go.
That's the beauty. We'll wax the brow. I'll wax your stick. Maybe get a little wax on mine. It'll be beautiful.
Wax on, wax off.
Here's the thing that's comical. My wife is, she's got twins in her. She's about 7 weeks away from giving birth, if all goes well, and she's in a hormonal funk. She's all over the moon. She's literally at home with a gun in her mouth if she's listening because her hormones are popping. So I have to face her ire when I get home. So it takes a big man. It takes a big man to continue in the face of this.
She's probably not going to like it, too, when you name the boy Ashley and the girl Anastasia.
Oh.
Well, she's a very lucky woman.
Yeah. Oh. She's lucky. That's right. She's lucky I'm not drunk.
You didn't leave the bullets there, did you?
She can get to them. Honey, if you're listening, whatever you got to do, I'll understand. I'm just saying if something tragic were to happen, you know. Okay. Now she's really getting angry. Let's say no. She sleeps until 8, right about now. All right, Ashley, I don't know what to do. I want to keep her around. Can we keep her around?
I can move on.
Why? We need somebody around here.
Keep me.
Yes. Anastasia,
she
Ashley.
Should meet
Lex Luthor. I'll tell you what you need to do. You need to come back early and often. We'll have you on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, and then I'll have you on Saturday and Sunday.
And Adam will come early and often, too.
Wait, what was the time again? 10 to 12 a night?
I'll see you at, I'll see you. When the street lights come on, that's when you hop in the Porsche and head over to the Ace Man's place.
Okay.
And remember the secret knock. PETA2.com is where you can find out more information. Also, Celebrity Car Magazine coming up. I'll tell you. Into cars, into the lifestyle.
Match made in heaven, the two of you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Anastasia, Ashley, thank you very much for coming in.
Thank you.
We do appreciate it. Come back anytime at all.
For sure.
We'll be right back after this.
It's the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam Carolla now at 866-901-ADAM. Good times.
Mm-hmm. Michael Rosenbaum is here. From Smallville, WB Thursdays, 8 o'clock. Plays Lex Luthor. I'm sorry, I'm disappointed. I just, you know, feel like Anastasia and I had a connection. And
yeah, you just went from a hot chick surfer to a bald villain weirdo.
Yeah, I needed something in between. You know what I mean? I needed a step. It's like falling off a loading dock. If someone would have just put a step at the halfway point, I feel like I could have made it. But now...
Maybe Kathy Griffin in between?
Right. Just something to ease your way in.
Yeah. Or even a hot dude. Yes, Kathy Griffin. Yes. If I could have... We could have brought Kathy, went from Anastasia, brought Kathy in at 8 o'clock, had you swing by about 9:10, 9:15. Right. I think I could have decompressed as it is. I got the bends.
Well, but you don't think I'm hot?
No, you're a good-looking man.
No doubt about that.
Teresa, you're into Michael, yes?
Teresa's hot.
Thank you.
Can I give really a quick shout-out to my driver, Lee, who drove me here this morning? He threw out his back coughing.
Oh, really?
Swear to God. So he's listening right now. He promised me he'd listen. Lee, I'll be out there shortly.
Guys, it's a bad sign, but guys do, even young guys will throw out their back. I know a guy who had to have back surgery because he got out of bed in a weird way.
Hmm.
And I'm just saying, have something loaded up in the excuse department if, in fact, you ever do throw out your back or separate your shoulder. You know, because guys are like, geez, what happened to your eye? You got a black eye. What'd you do, get in a fight? No, boyfriend's penis came out and hit me.
Wow.
And it's like, come up with something good.
He just got out of bed with a surfer, right?
Right,
maybe
right.
I stepped on her surfboard. It hit me.
Right. I went out with the surfer.
He did?
Yeah.
What was his name?
Oh.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm still not over Anastasia. Now, what was her name?
She was a professional surfer. Her name is Hannah.
He doesn't know her last name.
That sounds hot.
Well, when you get a girl's number, sometimes it's just Hannah Surfer.
Yeah, because sometimes you're dating a handful of other Hannahs.
Well,
there's Hannah trucker.
Hannah and her sisters.
Hannah and all her sisters. You, speaking of dating, I think you asked my beautiful blonde assistant out at some point.
What?
Yes.
Is that right?
Lindsay.
Wow.
Wait, Lindsay just came in the green room to say hello.
Did you put Lindsay assistant in your phone?
No, I don't. Is that true?
At a hockey game, well, I hear.
That's possible, yes.
You go to a lot of hockey games, right?
Yeah.
She goes to hockey games.
Right.
She's statuesque and blonde.
Yes.
Perhaps you asked her out.
Did she say yes?
Evidently not, because here she comes. Does she look familiar? She seem familiar to you?
Here she comes. Well, she looks familiar because she just came in the green room and said hello.
Oh, okay. Lindsay, did Michael ask you out at a hockey game?
No, we actually were at the hockey game because I know one of his friends.
Oh, see, so I didn't. I wasn't sleazy.
But you didn't ask?
I wasn't sleazy. We were just talking throughout most of the game.
Ah, but when a guy talks to a girl throughout most of the game he enjoys, it means he's interested.
Oh, she's blonde, tall, and beautiful. Give me a break here.
Yeah, no, I'm not. Look, you're only flesh and blood and heterosexual, as far as I can tell.
As far as I know.
I would ask beautiful Lindsay out as well if I was not gay. But what happened? Why didn't you go out?
Well, afterwards, I actually met his brother, too.
Mm-hmm.
I was talking to my friend.
Mm-hmm.
And afterwards, we went to some bar underneath the Staples Center with Cuba Gooding Jr.
Uh-huh, that's all you remember? Really?
That always happens just before a blackout.
Well,
yes.
Michael, today's your lucky day. You have a chance. You have a second chance here with Lindsay.
Yeah,
you don't
always get second chances.
Pretend we're not here.
I've been working out.
Okay.
I have the screech physique right now.
Well, that's good. I don't go for really built guys anyway.
Thank God for that. How about guys with some scruff?
That's okay.
We're going to do this. We're going to make this happen.
Okay. How about, Lindsay, right. How about it? As long as I've known you, you've not really been dating anyone, have you?
Not anyone really worth it,
You don't kill people.
But what's going on? And Lindsay, Dave, she's my assistant, so people think I'm
beautiful.
Exaggerating.
Beautiful. Long, flaxen
stunning
hair.
Yes.
Stunning.
Ample bosom.
Thanks.
Beautiful body.
That's harassment. Wow.
She's like fresh face, right, you know, she's like Noxzema girl pretty.
Sweet girl, athletic, runs marathons.
Yeah.
Let me see your hands. I'm a hand guy.
Really?
Oh, good nails.
Good nails?
Yeah.
Well, there's no dirt in them, that's always good.
No, that could be good too.
So how about it, Lindsay? How about it, Michael?
You're just trying to hook this up, aren't you?
Well, I mean, you guys went out, sort of. You watched a game, you tilted a few, but
we met.
We met
through Jerry Bruckheimer's assistant.
But let me ask you this, Michael. You did want to ask her out at the end of the meeting. You just never got around to it, or what happened?
What? Let's have some coffee, Lindsay. Very low-key. We'll have some coffee.
Coffee?
Miniature golf.
That's not going anywhere.
Well, it's 7 a.m.
No, you have some coffee.
We do have Miller Lights in the fridge, though.
Wow. Oh, really? And Lindsay, what about you? Be honest. Would you like to go out? He's a big star. He's on the WB.
I have hair in
Smallville.
Yeah, I like Smallville.
All right. Are you not? You're not establishing eye contact with Michael. I noticed that. Are you shy?
I'm establishing it now.
All right. You like what you see?
Yes.
Okay, you don't mind? He's got a shaved head. He has to do that for the role, you know?
Exactly.
But I have some hair now. I'm kicking it hair.
Yeah, I can see the hair. Yeah.
No, he's got hair.
Go ahead, feel it.
He's no Kojak.
No, he definitely didn't do it. He didn't do it because he was going bald. He did it because it's required.
And I'm an idiot.
Yeah, and he may be from Smallville, but his penis isn't.
Yes.
Tell you that right now.
And
Rendezville.
There's no time like Passover to start dating Jews.
That's perfect. Right. Or Rosenbaum, that's right.
I'm not a Jew. I'm not.
Blonde hair, blue eyes. Really?
It's
hold on, you're fired.
It's ironic. I'm not very religious at all, so this could work.
This could work.
All right, we'll see.
Also, Lindsay, I hadn't told you about this before, but when Lindsay first started as my assistant, I was asking a couple of questions about the family, and she mentioned that her father was a florist.
Yes.
And then mentioned that, he loves flowers. And I said, well, how's your parents? Are they still together? No, they're not together anymore. My dad's a florist. And then went on to mention your dad's partner. Kept saying my dad's partner.
No, they're still together. They're still together.
They are. They're parents.
Yes.
But I guess it's the florist and then the partner that made me think that your dad was gay for the first 3 months I knew you.
Well, he's like Martin Short, but not gay, from
What is that, the bride, the father of the bride?
All I'm saying is if my daughter starts telling everyone, talking about me, saying, yeah, dad's a florist, and, you know, him and his partner have had a little riff, but they're on the mend now, I will quickly reprogram her.
I am a gay American.
All right, so straight dad.
Straight dad. Good with colors, but
And
dad.
Because he's a florist, you don't even like flowers, right?
No, I like flowers. I do. I don't like carnations.
What kind of flowers?
I like kind of like mixed bouquets and tulips and stuff like that. I'm not a red roses
tulips,
person.
I like that. I can just pick them off the street.
Yeah,
whatever.
You can pick wildflowers are good.
On your way to coffee.
Michael, let me reset here. Michael Rosenbaum is here from Smallville, WB Thursday nights.
Lex Luthor.
8 yes. o'clock. Lindsay is here from my house every day about 9. She's my assistant. She's beautiful. These guys went to a hockey game together with a bunch of friends. The connection wasn't made
Sparks
then,
flew.
But I think it may be made
a love
now.
Line.
I didn't know either.
Michael, are you single?
Yeah, I am single.
You are?
Yes.
You what? Hesitated.
Yeah, you did.
No, I am single. You know, do I want to be single? I don't know.
Sure, listen.
The dating thing.
You have no problem meeting women, though, right?
No, I don't, but it's like, you know, I'm 33 now. It's time to, you know.
Time to settle in and have some coffee, huh?
Maybe have some coffee and some tulips.
I agree. You know, I'm sort of the same way. It's like, hey, I'm 41. My wife's pregnant, you know, with twins. It's time to have a 19-year-old.
You finally
that's basically.
Who surfs?
Who surfs, yes. Good call. Because, you know, we have so much in common.
You guys are like two peas.
What did it for you? Double.
What did it for you, man?
What got me married?
Yeah.
What made me settle down?
How'd you know that, hey, this is the one? A heartbeat? What happened? I mean, was it like...
Ashley?
Yeah.
Well, you see what she was wearing?
I want to know this, too.
Oh, my wife?
How did you know?
This is important for me.
Well, I do... I think a lot of guys, if I could get serious and sort of philosophical for a moment...
Can we have some serious music, please?
I think if a lot of guys' instincts are bad. And if you're left to your own devices, you would probably be single and possibly date strippers your entire life, if you could. You know what I'm saying? It's sort of like a child would live off nothing but French fries and pizza. It's kind of up to the mom to sort of slide in and go, no, you're going to eat your vegetables. It's for the kid's greater good. You argue with her at the time. I feel like a lot of guys sort of need to be brought to intimacy, and then ultimately, it's a better life. You fight it.
Wow.
You don't want to get married. You want to be single. You want to date around. You want to have fun. But ultimately, it's sort of empty calories. And I was, you know, I resisted getting married for years and years and years. And then once I got married, I actually was happier.
How old were you?
I was 54.
Sweet.
And dying of prostate cancer. What the hell? Well, I got about 3 weeks, honey. Enjoy.
Yeah. Married men actually live longer because their wives take care of them and they're happier.
Yeah, I don't have that part of it going. But or the happiness part. No, there is a part where you find yourself resisting something that you're running from something you don't even know why you're running from it at a certain point. There's a part that's liberating to sort of let yourself go and give in. And now starting a family, I think I'm starting to feel the same way. The moral of the story is you don't always know what's best for you. You may know what's best for you in your career, possibly. You may know what's best for you in other situations, other aspects of your life. But sometimes a woman, when it comes to relationships, has to kind of tell you what you need. And you know what? You listen to them and you're happier.
Maybe I need an older woman.
Yes. Hey, take my wife. There you go.
Lindsay seems very mature.
Yeah.
Lindsay, how old are you?
28.
That's not bad.
That's not
no.
young.
No, you guys.
Not too young.
No, you're right there.
I'm not
the 19-year-old in the stripper outfit,
yeah.
Though, so I don't know about you know, what you're into.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what he's into. He's into soft hits from the 80s.
Yeah.
We've learned from getting on the internet. He likes Olivia Newton-John and Hall & Oates.
Always edit your own bio.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, hang on. Giving me a heart attack. I know what that is.
This is a great song. And again, you couldn't tell what decade this was in. It could have been from the 50s, could have been from the 90s. Heart attack.
It's just, that's what it is. You know I'm right.
I know you're right.
Oh, Olivia, listen to that voice.
The fact, Michael,
Pearl Jam, right?
The fact that you, the fact that you knew it was Olivia Newton-John's heart attack after one hit on
one
a Synsonic
drum
is very sad.
And, yeah, it is. Kind
of. But Lindsay, you could be perched on Michael's shoulders at the next Olivia Newton-John concert.
I like 80s music too, but different. More yeah, like glam
there's
rock.
Anastasia waving to us.
Bye, sweetie
you.
P. Lock yourself in my trunk. I'll be there in about an hour and 45 minutes.
I love you.
Say hello to Hannah for me.
I know. Oh.
See you later. She's nice.
She's giving Adam a heart attack.
She's too young. She's too young.
Yeah.
19.
Huh? Yeah.
Man, when you were like 18, she was zero.
Well, that's a good point. That's great math you've done. Yes. She's zero, and then she was at one when I was 20. I can't think of what's up with her. Maybe the salt water's eating away at her brain or something like that.
You say that now. She's gone. Oh, she's getting hurt.
No, I'm just saying she's a beautiful woman. Why? Why me? All right, so here's Maneater. Oh, no, this is Heart Attack. Yeah, Maneater. That's my favorite. Do we have any of that?
There we go.
Oh, no.
Now, do you actually like this music?
I swear to God I do. It just soothes me. You know, you're driving down, you got a little road rage. You listen, put some Hall & Oates on or some Olivia.
Mm-hmm.
You're sitting pretty.
Lindsay, could you be with a man who's into man-eating?
Yeah, that's okay.
I'm doing the math.
Good Christ, I'm gay.
I'm more of a method of modern love.
Okay.
Hall & Oates.
All right. So maybe a connection here?
Yes, maybe.
They're playing at UCLA next month.
Oh, he even knows the schedule.
You know when Hall & Oates is going to be at Pollock Pavilion? And
Ambrosia's at Universal City on the 27th. June 30th is Hall & Oates. Pat Benatar, my birthday, July 14th. Folks, be there. Gore Hills, I'll be there.
Wow. Yeah. Well, maybe that's the date. So Benatar's going to be playing on your birthday.
Yes.
You can go see that. I would go only if she promises to do Hell Is For Children.
Ooh.
If she does Hell Is For Children.
Well, there's a battlefield, Adam, right here.
It certainly is.
It absolutely
full of 19-year-old surfer girls.
Yes. I can't believe it. You just heard, he likes 80s music, but you didn't know that I liked him as much, did you?
My beautiful Anastasia wasn't even born until most of these songs were out for 2-3 years before she was born.
That's sad.
Sad. It's good. Her mind is pure. It's not.
You're going to be the best double date ever. You, Anastasia, Lindsay, and Michael.
And then later on, we just all flop in the same king-size bed and throw caution to the wind. Whatever happens,
happens. Wild lovemaking session. Wonderful.
Yes.
Beautiful.
Yes. I'm like, Anastasia, beautiful, smooth ass. You know, wait a minute, it's Michael's head.
Wow. Not so smooth anymore, but yes.
No, there's all right. A little scruff.
All right. I think you guys are going to go on forever. We need to take a break. I think we should just, let's recalibrate. Let's reboot here. We'll come back. We'll wrap up. We'll work out this date.
The details.
Then,
we'll
also, keeping up with our religious week, we have a Scientologist who is coming in here, who is going to tell us the virtues of Scientology. Dick Vitale. Tori Spelling still coming in. Looks like there's too much show for just one day, Brusco. Why don't you reel it in? We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back after this. Yeah, sing it, Michael.
That's a great song. Another Olivia. Olivia Newton-John. How sexy was she in the day? The black leather pants and grease.
Yeah.
How about Xanadu? I'd watch Xanadu just for her. And the guy from The Warriors, Michael Beck.
Yeah.
He was hot. I'm not gay, but I'm comfortable with it.
The jury's still out. But Australian is one of the hotter nationalities for a chick. The accent works. The whole surf and sun thing.
Yeah.
Swedish and Australian.
Yeah, works very nice.
Michael, by the way, during the commercial, laid down the gauntlet to one Jimmy Kimmel. Michael says he can name any song from the 80s that he hears before anyone else can. Mm-hmm. Jimmy Kimmel's made a similar claim. I say, gauntlet has been laid down. A battle shall take place.
Let's do it.
We got to schedule this.
Let's do this.
Yes.
It's kind of sad. It's a sad
clash of the homos, I think we'll call it.
Yeah.
Michael Rosenbaum here. He plays Lex Luthor in Smallville, WB, Thursdays at 8. Yeah. Jimmy, because he likes bad music and that comes from that era, also And but by the way, I'm not going to get all highfalutin on you like Dave Damashek over here, who pretends to listen to nothing but Radiohead and Mighty Mouse, whatever.
Modest Mouse,
Smashing Dumplings, whatever the kids are listening to. The Nervosa.
I do know these bands. Myself.
Point is I will agree. A lot of these songs, you know what? A lot of these songs are. A lot of these songs are like playmates that you saw when you were in the 80s in the high school. Maybe they need a little trim downstairs. Maybe they don't look so good today, but they remind you of a time.
Absolutely.
And for that reason, they'll always be your favorite. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, now
Rock
Kimmel.
Rock Me Amadeus. Remember that?
Yes. Falco.
Oh, Falco.
Who could forget? Yeah, Kimmel loves Huey Lewis, and Kimmel has done a lot of radio. Wow, that was quick.
Wow,
right?
Was
name two other Falco hits.
Wait.
Putting on the Ritz, or is that Taco?
No, that wasn't him.
He had two other hits?
Yeah.
He definitely had
Vienna
the one
Calling.
Oh, right.
Vienna Calling.
Der Commissar.
Oh, that was Commissar, right.
Commissar, yeah. Come on, guys.
Yeah, you this say that like it's Ritz. A good thing.
I mean, I'm just insulting.
It's Der Commissar, not Falco?
You don't have Der Commissar?
I hear
right,
that.
Right.
Who is that? Who is this?
Dirk Diggler? Dirk Commissar.
Sorry, this is going far too gay for me. Yeah.
It's exciting, though, isn't it?
Yeah. So let's straighten out again. You are going to take my assistant, Lindsay, out.
Their commissar.
Yes.
That could happen. We're going to have coffee, tulips, and
talk about it.
Thank you, Miller Lights.
Now, you're going to have coffee. Is this a daytime date, or are you going to be drinking coffee out of Michael's navel at 2 a.m.?
I've got an innie, so that helps.
Oh, you got any? Yeah. Fantastic.
It's going
to
help.
I'll have to slurp it up.
Wow. Yeah.
A slurper. You're in. Let's do this.
Yeah. How about it?
Sounds good.
Yeah. I mean, not just radio talk. You're both into this, right? You're young. You're attractive. You both look nice. What's wrong?
Absolutely.
All right.
Why not?
The body language is very good. His hand's been over there towards her.
Hey, I've been a gentleman. I haven't done a damn. I'm holding a Sharpie.
Adriana? Is that what
Hi.
That is? Yes.
Hi. I just wanted to say hi to Michael Rosenbaum.
Hi.
And I also, I had a baby name for you, Adam.
Oh, yes.
Oil Patricia.
Hmm. Like oil filter?
Yes.
Yeah,
Teresa.
Yeah, the,
It's like Teresa.
This is going off David Allen Greer's jag from yesterday, but it's all academic now, because I'm gone, Daddy.
Gone.
You know what I'm saying?
Do you need it tested out for you, or will we wait for him?
Listen, I said, like I said, name him Hitler and Mussolini. I don't care.
He's running off.
I'm going off to Hermosa. With Anastasia.
Anastasia, yeah. Ashley. Beautiful blonde surfer lady.
Uh-oh. Jimmy's on.
Sorry, I'm not a blonde surfer lady. I apologize.
All right, so you're on hold for 20 minutes to give Filteria, huh?
Oil Filtresa, and to say hi to Michael Rosenbaum, because I'm a big fan of his.
Oh,
he's a really,
sweet.
Really, really hot guy. And if she doesn't go out for coffee with him, she's silly.
Wow. Yeah.
I'll go out for coffee.
You're silly. You're goofy.
All right. The great Jimmy Kimmel's on the phone. Jimmy?
I agree. I hate to break up the love connection that's going on here.
But you heard the gauntlet was laid down.
I did hear that, yeah. And I have to say, so far I'm impressed. I think that he's a worthy opponent.
Oh, well, let's do one practice
you,
one. Mike Lynch with the music. Pull up some 80s gem and see who can react first.
This is
okay.
Just a taste of what
I'm on the telephone, so it's a little hard to hear. So be quiet for a second, Dave.
Nice excuse, Kimmel.
Yes. Passover. Let the voice and diction pass you over. Go ahead.
Oh, that's
Simple Minds.
That's Simple Minds.
All right.
Don't you forget about me.
We'll give it a tie. You nice. Have, let's try a few
he's on
more.
The phone, right? He got a 5-second
yeah,
delay on
he
that.
He sure. Should have a handicap.
Yeah. How about Life in a Northern Town? There's no way, Han. Oh,
I can't even hear it.
Bon Jovi. Am I right?
Yeah.
Song name?
I know him as just Jovi, dude.
I'm a cowboy.
Yeah. Dead or alive.
Dead or alive.
Yes, Jimmy.
You know what? We should do this in the studio, though, because it's very difficult for me to hear.
Oh, Blaze of Glory.
This is Blaze of Glory. This is already with excuses from Kimmel.
Well, he's on a cell phone.
By the way, Blaze of Glory, was that technically in the 80s?
Could have
been 91.
I believe that was the 90s, which falls out of our realm.
Interesting.
Ooh, I've got a competitor here.
All right, we'll get a high-stakes battle going, though.
Yeah.
We got to schedule this. All right.
Whoever wins.
Men at Work down under.
All right.
Oh, I couldn't even. Okay.
Listen, I'll tell you what, Jimmy.
Yeah.
I'm going to need someone to take over the show, by the way, because I'm going on tour with Anastasia.
Oh, all right. Well, yeah, I'll jump right in there.
Yeah.
Michael and I will just play 80s music trivia the whole time.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I'll be gone for about 3 weeks. The OP tour starts out in Hermosa, makes its way up the coast, and then we do the island hopping. We go to Australia, and then it's Hawaii.
Great.
Yeah.
Your ratings might go down once we kick into some Olivia, but nonetheless.
This is a bet. Whoever loses has to shave their head.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? You are on, buddy.
All right, well, why don't we make it the back or something since I need my hair.
Yes. You have to shave your back or your front, depending if you have any on your back or your front, Michael.
Do you?
I have maybe a bacon strip or something down there. I'm clean.
Right. All right.
Yeah, we'll talk about that.
All right.
All right, Jimmy.
Good. I'm in for that.
All right, we'll set this up. Thank you. Jimmy Kimmel.
Jimmy. He's
strong,
a great guy.
Strong man in the 80s. Oh, just for Jimmy.
Huey Lewis in the News.
One of my favorite Huey Lewis
this
songs.
This is going to be a great war. Michael, very good.
You're yeah. Like very quick.
This is all I know. All right, I got C-minus in high school,
Olivia
but I know every 80s song.
Phil?
Yeah, what's going on, Adam?
You big fan of Michael Rosenbaum?
Oh, you know what? Actually, Michael, how you doing?
How are you?
Great, man. You know, I actually loved you as the very hot-looking chick in Sorority Boys.
Yes. Thank you so much.
There was nothing small, Bill, about that caboose, huh?
No. You know, I was in drag for 3 months. My mother calls me after the movie came out and goes, Michael, it's great. All my friends say I look exactly like you. Like, well, I'm a man in drag, Mom. That's not good. You look like Twisted D. Snyder.
So yeah. Big fan of Pat Benatar, huh?
Oh, huge.
Yeah, she's playing in July on your birthday.
Yep, absolutely, Agora Hills.
We'll have to come check.
Oh, Little Hell is for Children for all you Benatar fans. Sorry for
this is your
stepping on
Benatar.
It. This is my song. I got to tell you, you know, I don't brag and I normally don't talk about myself. But when I bust out into Hell is for Children, and this is the part, this is the preamble. You know, I'm not singing at this point. I'm saying a lot of you out there had some trouble with Mom and Dad, and this one's going out to the folks out there, the forgotten children, the latchkey kids, the ones that weren't born with the silver spoons in their mouths, the ones that had to find their own way. Hold your head up, kids, because this one's for you. And then I get into it. And, you know, right now the room's pretty subdued at this point, you know. But they feel a storm coming on. It's that kind of thing where you're out on the prairie, and all of a sudden a little gust of wind knocks your hat off, and you look down at it, and then you look at the skies, and you see thunderclouds approaching, and they know it's coming. And by the time we get to the end where I've just broken into free-form running in place, and the crazy karate chops and crescent kicks into the air with the sweat streaming. Sweat, I don't know if it's tears or sweat, but it's streaming down my face. Powerful. Dave, you've been there. I mean, stop me.
Too moving for words. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Hell is for Children with Adam Carolla and Pat Benatar 97.1.
I wouldn't be surprised. I wouldn't be surprised if she didn't bring me up on stage.
Why wouldn't she? You know, her husband's the guitarist.
Yeah.
Maybe you can get a little menage.
You can hit him with your best shot.
Oh.
Thank you.
Bring him and Anastasia up there.
Olivia?
Yeah. Mm. Oh, it'll be perfect. You and Lindsay, my beautiful assistant, will be in the audience. She's on your shoulders, and she got the Bic lighter over her head and her top pulled up over her head as well.
Bald-headed Jimmy Kimmel after he loses his bet.
Wouldn't that be something?
Yeah. Yeah, here's where it really kicks into overdrive here. Here's where it comes. Yeah.
Give us a taste.
Hell is for Children.
Yeah, growl.
Right?
Here's, but I talk it. Such a mess. I can carry it out a little. It's a theatrical thing. You people haven't been on stage, don't know. You'll have to entertain.
We're bringing back the 80s, Adam.
Yes.
Absolutely.
It'd be great. Oh, there weren't any AIDS or computers. There was AIDS. Oh, maybe there was.
Unfortunately.
Well, we called it grids. Now, here's where I go into my crazy karate chopping. Now, right about now, I'm running in place. And now, oh, yeah. Now, those are kicking out. Come on.
Do it.
I can't run in place. I'll start sweating. I don't want to get my stink on Anastasia after the show. Hell is for hell. Hell is for hell. Audience crying, jubilant, on their feet. Yep. Guys playing. All the guys, the guitars are all shaped like the flying V. Yep. All shaped like vaginas. Guys, I guess he's got the cowbell going. Now, here's the move where I go with the guitar player, and I do that thing where I pull the mic out, and I make it like I'm playing a guitar with one fat string. It's a cool move. Now, here's what I'm doing at this point. I'm walking over to the bass player, and we're pretending to have a conversation, and then crack each other up and walk away laughing.
You whisper in his ear. Yeah. Only you and him can hear.
We're the only ones who know. I'm not saying anything, but it seems like we're saying something funny.
Absolutely.
Ooh, what are we talking about? The world will never know, but it's funny as S.
Yep. Yeah.
Now I perch back over the mic stand, and I plant the mic back into the thing, and I just pace back and forth like a caged tiger. And they know the eruption of energy is going to come for me any second. And I go, hell! And I'm running in place. Hell is for hell! Yes, hell is for hell, and in the big crescendo, people anticipate the crescendo that's coming.
I am right now.
Here it comes.
Are the pants coming off?
No,
pants have been off.
Oh, they've been off.
Oh yeah.
Yes.
Where were you?
I hopefully behind it.
Pants are gone, long gone. Now the crazy running in place and the flailing in the air begins. Karate chopping, the punching. Now I'm over with the drummer, and I get up on the stand. I'm up on the lift, and I end up doing one of those David Lee Roth sort of crazy karate drop.
The Ralph Macchio, the karate kid.
That's right. That's right.
Jump
yes.
Off stage.
Yes, I go into the praying lotus.
Absolutely.
Well, wow. Thanks to Michael for letting us know all those plot points of Smallville.
Thank you, son. We're talking about 80s music, which is great. That's why I'm here.
Oh, the producers must be delighted.
Oh, they're happy.
All right, let me give you a good plug and send you on your way. Smallville. Wednesday, yes. Thursday nights on the WWB, 8 o'clock, Smallville.
Big finale. Lex is becoming really evil. You're going to harden my heart in the background.
Wow. Flash? Fire? Fire? Fire?
Quarter flash.
Quarter flash.
Yeah.
Wow.
You got it.
Wow. Nice. I got to believe I get the assist on that one.
That's
though.
Pretty good.
All right. We'll get Kimmel in here. We'll get you back.
Absolutely. I'm in.
We'll bring
and your trophy. Lindsay will cheer you from the side.
Well, thank you, Lindsay.
Is that date on?
It's on.
It's on.
It's on.
When are you guys, when is coffee? When are we going
When do I get back? Going to do some shooting up in Vancouver when I come back? Maybe
okay,
some coffee.
Definitely.
Maybe a muffin.
Okay.
Nice.
Sounds good.
Love muffin.
All right, kids, watch Smallville. Big finale's coming up.
I just came up with something that's cool. I don't care what you're doing if you're unemployed. Don't say, how about tomorrow? What are you doing tomorrow as a guy? Say when I get back from Vancouver.
Shooting in Vancouver.
I'm picking up
is
a few
good?
Things. Got to pick up
hot.
Some stuff.
Yeah.
I got to do a little ADR work. Get a little loop in.
Some pickup shots.
I got a loop for the Corolla show.
I'm telling you, if you're talking to a chick and you're saying, how about, you want to go out?
You're done.
What about tonight? What do you do tonight? What day is it? Thursday? How about Friday? How about tomorrow? But what would really set a hook is if you said, got to finish something up in Vancouver. Pick a city.
I'll talk to you
I'll
later.
Be back.
Vancouver sounds good.
I should be back in Moose Jaw for the weekend.
I'll be back early in the week. I'll be back early next week. I'll give you a buzz. Oh, you're in, right, Lindsay?
Yeah, sounds great.
Hey, maybe I'll talk to you then.
It's the hard to get
That's
there.
Right.
It's a maybe.
Yeah.
Right.
Maybe.
And then just beat the crap out of her. Really, really go all the way. All right, Michael. Thank you very much. We'll take a quick break. Smallville. We'll be back to talk a little Scientology. See if I can't be turned around after this.
Danny Bonaducci, and you're listening to the Adam Carolla Show.
Oh, yes, you are. So, we're continuing with our religious week. We have a Scientologist who's going to come in and see if they can win me over to Scientology. Tori Spelling will not be coming in, but good news, Dick Vitale still going to be phoning in.
Same thing.
Same person. She's going to reschedule and a migraine headache, evidently. My wife, Lynette's on the phone. Lynette?
Hi, Pumpkin.
Hi, sweetie pea. We got to make this fast because I got to get out to Hermosa.
Okay.
Yeah. Did you hear me speaking to that pig, Anastasia?
Yeah, no, I didn't. I actually heard the very ending. I was just listening to Mark and Brian.
Oh. Let me describe her physically. Sort of nappy, dark hair, heavy-set gal.
Mm-hmm.
If you like jowls and goiters, mm-hmm. she's the girl for you. You know, he had to play it up like she was cute over the radio.
Right.
Because it's
thing.
Theater of the mind. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But, you
That's
know.
That's not true. She was hot.
Oh,
you
she
said
was.
As much Dave. During a commercial.
Check. What did she look like?
She was hot, and Adam Dave. Told me so during the commercial.
Oh, really?
What? Come on, buddy. She's pregnant. She's all full of hormones.
I think the good news is,
stuff.
I think Adam was just showing off for his friends in here.
Oh, yeah. That's all right.
Yeah, but what about the nice speech about how you made him a better man?
That's when I tuned in. I did hear that.
Oh, you did?
I love that.
All right. Well, let's get that on a loop.
That was
get you an earpiece and call it a life. We'll get you some sunglasses that has me doing chores. Meanwhile, I'll be on top of Anastasia in Hermosa Beach.
Oh, okay.
All right, baby doll.
I'm fixing your dinner for you right now.
Oh, really?
I'm marinating the steaks.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Is that a lie?
No, it's true.
Really?
I get the steaks out. Yeah.
Yeah, she knows.
Make
She's this all theatrics.
No.
You know, Cindy, Dave's wife, made ossobuco.
Ossobuco 2 nights ago.
Nice.
Yeah. How do you top
that? I've made that before.
You have?
Yeah.
Oh, maybe.
Does Cindy cook for you, Dave, every day?
Every night.
She's
a dynamite lady.
Mm-hmm.
I cook for Adam every night.
Right.
In the beginning.
What did I eat last night?
Kookaroo.
Kookaroo. Right.
I was going to cook for you last
What did I eat the night before?
12-day leftover of tortilla soup.
Right.
That I made.
Day before that?
Leftover.
Day before that.
You like the leftovers.
Have I proved my point? Yes, you missed the day when I ate raisins and cottage cheese.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. All right. Oh, you never feel like more of a king in your own castle than when you're eating raisins and cottage cheese for dinner.
But I fixed it up for you. That's what you want.
That's true.
Dinner.
You did. You did.
Yes, I did.
Put Molly on the phone. Let me talk to her.
You're upsetting the dog. Now you got her all upset.
All right, baby doll.
All right.
Get back to Mark and Brian.
Okay, bye.
All right. I'll tell you, the kid's taking it better than I thought. A lot of women would be upset.
Well,
you know?
She knows she gets the house.
I guess so. She gets the dog, she gets the house. And again, better the twins never know their father. Say I died in a F-14 when I punched out over Da Nang.
Running off with Anastasia now is the right thing to do.
Better now than 18 months from now.
Right.
After the bonding has already taken
place. It's
really
thoughtful of you.
Hey, you know what? I didn't do it for praise. It's not why I got into banging 19-year-olds. I didn't do it, you know. Mark?
Yeah, good morning, Adam.
You have a poem about Scientology?
Mark the poet.
Mark the poet. You have a poem about Scientology?
Morning, Dave, too. Yeah, I do. In fact, I wrote one for Passover, but I'd love to do either one you'd love.
Well, I got my fingers crossed, and I'm hoping for a good, solid C- here, Mark. So lay it on us. Give us a Scientology poem.
All right, I will. Connect you to the E-meter. Seems like you have issues. Like Fat Tad's lover, a Mount Vesuvius of Kleenex tissues. Read some Dianetic books, only the wackiness is free. Then check out our poster boy in Mission Impossible 3. So Mark, the poet's about liberation, let me give you a hand. L. Ron Hubbard is God. There, I just saved you $40,000.
Wow, powerful.
Better than most.
Yeah. And better than most. We will have our Scientologist in here in just a couple of few. I'm guessing she'll take umbrage with that. But effective and necessary. That's what poets do.
And I predict, based on past experience, my cousin Brandon, who listens in Harrisburg, PA, online every day, I am anticipating a limerick because he can't stand Mark the Poet and always responds with a poem of his own. I'm awaiting that.
Mark, do you have some website you want to plug?
Yeah, Ishtar.
That's enough.
No.
It never gets old.
Does it
ever get old?
No.
I'll tell you what. Let's take a break. Have Mark plug the website during the break. And then we'll come back. Every other poem you can plug your website, Mark. That's our new deal. We'll take a quick break. We'll be back. As you know, I have a quest to find a religion for not only me, but the two twins I'll never know. I'd like them to go on. I want them. They're going to need to be strong. They're going to have a faith and a conviction without a male around. Male's going to be in Hermosas, drinking Hermosa Beach, drinking Hermosas.
Their Hermosas. New father
That's
is
right.
L. Ron.
That's right. Oh, all right. I think I invented a new drink, the Hermosa. Not the Mimosa. This is champagne and sand. The Hermosa. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back to talk Scientology after this.
There are many questions about the Ace Man Show. His big tad fat ass.
Yay.
Is Angie Fitzsimmons a lush?
Yay.
Make August look like Katie Lane?
Yay.
Is producer Jeremy Brusca a chubby lesbian?
Yay and double yay.
So when you want an answer, this is how you ask. How say you? Yay or nay?
I say yay.
How say you? Yay or nay?
I say yay.
How say you?
How say you?
Yeah or nay?
Oh, no.
Nay.
Nay, you say.
Flew a little too close to the sun that way, Icarus, and crashed into the sea.
Yeah. Rich Banks' neighbors must be delighted to hear him cranking that
Our
crap out
Smith,
on the Casio
yeah.
at 2 a.m. from his mom's garage. Thank you, Rich Banks, for that. All right. So we have our Scientologist who is primed to come in. We'll talk to her in a moment. Again, I'm picking out a religion. Also, stop eating in the mic. Nay, I say to your
I'm celebrating Pesach with matzah.
Yeah, do it in your car. Dick Vitale is going to be calling in. Dickie V. I don't know what he's going to talk about. Basketball season is over as far as the college hoops goes, but he has other opinions outside of the hardwood, and we'll
Seems
hear
like
from him.
Seems like a one-track mind, though.
Well, we'll find out what his range is. But first, it's time for Teresa Strasser and her news.
Zacharias Moussaoui, in his death penalty trial, took the stand today and immediately attacked his own defense team. He claimed that his lawyers don't have his best interests in mind and accused them of, quote, criminal non-assistance.
Mm. Wow. You know, they talk about the whole martyrdom thing, which is, well, if we kill him, then he becomes a martyr. But according to a lot of experts, that's not how it works. If you're killed at the hands of the infidels, then you're not a martyr. You must be killed in battle or blow yourself up at a Sparrow Pizza or something like that, but you can't do it at the hands of the infidels. So I say, with that in mind, we kill this guy, and we do it in a spectacular way.
With
you know?
Pigs. We let pigs eat them to death, because the worst thing you can do to them is for them to touch a pig.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
All right.
That's
really?
A sacrilege or something
yeah.
for them to rub against a pig. So.
Yeah, they even thought that's what they say. That's why whenever I'm in Israel and I have to go to the coffee shop, I always put a pig in my knapsack.
Right, just to keep yourself
there was,
safe.
Yeah, there you was can, actual discussion about
there
that
was.
In Israel, putting pigs on the buses. That was actually
to
true.
To stop them from blowing up the bus.
Right, because if it blew up and the pig blew up, it might splatter on the suicide bomber in there before they wouldn't get to with the 72 virgins.
Here's all I know. You can't judge. Everyone's exactly the same. All religions are exactly equal, and it's definitely not the people. Those are the things I've learned from this entire Middle East problem. But yeah, Zacharias got up there, and he did a lot of damage to his case a few weeks ago when he was talking about wanting to fly a fifth plane into the White House and so on and so forth. We happen to have tapes of his courtroom rants. And again, if you think that was bad, he kept going. And if he's
back on the stand today,
yeah.
he's already
attacking his lawyers, but apparently he's already really incriminated.
Well, I'm saying if he's not making any friends with the American public, I'll tell you that right now. The jurors are all American. If they didn't want to send this guy to the chair before, they certainly are after they heard the rest of his rants.
I would go to Mount Vernon, dig up the corpse of George Washington, and use his wooden teeth to nibble.
I'm Lincoln's stovepipe hat.
That magician would be in for a surprise.
I wanted to get the candles to the Golden Gate Bridge and then use them to whip lead Greenwood.
Oh.
I'll be an American, my ass.
I'll tell you. I say send this guy to... Forget about due process. Take the guy to the chair right now.
It's almost like he's asking for
it. He couldn't possibly do any more damage. He couldn't possibly.
It couldn't get worse.
No,
I will go to Cape Canaveral. Steal the original Apollo rocket, Statue of Liberty.
Lady Liberty.
I wanted to go to Boston and light a beacon in the Old North Church, except instead of a lantern, it would be the skull of Mark Twain.
Oh.
What?
I wanted to reassemble the members of Grand Funk Railroad and make them perform We're an American Band while being electrocuted in their testicles.
Okay, now listen, I've heard enough. I don't know if this guy, what religion this guy is. Maybe he's a Jew. Maybe he's celebrating Passover. I don't care. I say we put him down and we put him down now. I can't believe this.
I wanted catapulted into the swimsuit competition of the Miss USA pageant.
God, we got him when we did.
I plan to reenact Benjamin Franklin's famous electricity experiment, except the key would be a baby, and the kite would be made from the skin of the dog from Frasier.
Oh!
I wanted to go to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, steal Bob Dylan's harmonica, put it in my butt crack, and fart. The times, they are a-changing.
Well, he would play better than Bob, even that way. But still,
but
I disagree with that. No, you're right.
This
I disagree with what this guy's done. Thank God we got him before he was able to execute anything.
To the beaches of Normandy, where the soldiers died on the D-Day, and make a sandcastle where all the towers look suspiciously like penises.
Okay. You know what? Mike, that's... Please. That is enough of that.
Yes.
I don't call myself a patriot, but I'm offended by this.
I call him a creep.
Yeah. I mean, I know we have free speech, but...
Yeah, no, you got to draw the line somewhere.
Absolutely.
I'm sorry. Anyway, go ahead,
Let's
Teresa.
Move on to Let's some more forward. Wholesome entertainment.
Yes, please.
The music of Queen proved to be a daunting task for the American Idol finalists who sang on Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
Last night, Ace, your favorite,
mm-hmm.
Elliot and Bucky were in the final three. Here's Ryan Seacrest with Who Was Eliminated.
After the vote, leaving us tonight on American Idol is... Bucky.
Bucky tossed out. Dickie V's on the blower. Dickie?
Is this Mark and Brian?
And that's a little bit of a theme.
How are you, party people?
Thanks for coming on the show. We normally think Dick Vitale, we think college hoops, but you're going to expand your horizons just a little bit and get into the American Idol, huh?
Well, you know, people laugh at the idea of Dickie V reporting on American Idol, but if you think about it, Adam, there are many similarities. Both are filled with PTPers, primetime players who overcome obstacles and persevere. And, you know, I'm not going to BS you anymore. Dickie V's addicted to speed. He needs the money. You're paying him to talk about hillbilly teenagers singing karaoke. He's game, baby.
You're on the crank, and you can't afford to get paid just 3-4 months out of the year. I understand. What'd you think of Bucky being eliminated last night?
Well, Bucky Covington was eliminated. He's a real surf and turfer. I think that means homosexual. Have to check. He's from North Carolina, though. You know that.
Yeah, Southern.
He's a Tar Heel, baby. Mm-hmm. He wants to be like Mike, baby. The problem is that the kid gave it his all in his song. He sang Fat Bottom Girls, which is a tribute to another fallen idol, Mandisa. But it ended up working against him. You know, I don't know about you, but everyone sang a Queen song. I thought I was going to get hepatitis C just watching, baby.
Yeah, I know. True. Who do you like, though? I mean, who are you picking for the finalists?
I'll tell you, Adam, you do me a favor. Call Dr. Drew, because I got a McFever, baby.
Oh, really?
I hope that's treatable.
Yeah, it might be Catherine McPhee. She's a local girl. Dickie V has a condo in Sherman Oaks, and we're neighbors.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
You know, Mike August should be all over that booking.
Yeah, I know. But again, he swore to book from only within the building.
Yeah, and that would, you know, hey, Mike, I hear she knows a lot about the White Shadow. Mick Fever talking about salami. Gypsy Tooth Dunkaroo is that joke inside.
Yeah, a little inside one from Dickie
V. I have no idea what's happening.
It's a long story, but, well, why can't we amuse ourselves every once in a while? Yes, Dickie, I'm a big fan of McPhee as well, or McPhee, whatever she's calling herself. And she is a local girl right here from the Valley. I grew up mere blocks away from the beautiful Catherine McPhee, or whatever her name is. So her, anyone else, do you think Pickler might do a good job? Do you have any other thoughts on that?
You could call Pickler, you know, that, you know, I like Paris Bennett, but I just been doing other things around. Oh, I'm not going to get into it right now.
No, I understand. I understand.
It's not a good thing.
Yes, yes. All right, Dickie V, thanks for being part of the program.
All right, stay in school.
Bye.
Dickie V out, baby.
Nice
Thank
job.
You for that. Wow. Well, next week on Idol is going to be the musical stylings of Rod Stewart. I'm Teresa Strasser, and that was the news.
It's time. For Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
Like that, Dickie V. Brings the same energy.
Yeah.
It's crank talking. Anyway, very tough loss last night for the Dodgers. Second in as many nights at the hands of the Pittsburgh Pirates. Slightly less lousy pitching for the Buccos than the Bums. And the Bucks take 2 of 3 in that series. Arizona won. Padres won at the Florida Marlins. Meantime, that creep Barry Bonds and his pals were rained out for the second straight night. A clear indication that God is doing his best to keep Barry from ever playing a game.
What are the Dodgers? They're around 500?
They're only 9 games in.
What are they?
They're 4-5.
4.5 and 4.5?
That's 500.
That's the beauty of baseball. They're 500. Everyone's perpetually 500. Everyone's 500 at the All-Star break. Everyone finishes at 500. Just please.
It's
everyone
our national
stop watching.
Pastime.
It's like reading a highlights magazine in the doctor's office when you're a kid.
All right. 16 more days till the NFL draft.
Ah,
how about that?
Now we're talking.
All right. American League. Angels got whipped at home by Texas. Seattle won in Cleveland. Oakland lost to Minnesota. NHL, San Jose Sharks have clinched a playoff spot, and of course, all season long, they've been led by the greatest name in sports, Jonathan Chichu. So he's in. That'll be fun to follow him through the playoffs. NBA, the now mighty Clippers took care of the league's new embarrassment, the Portland Trail Blazers. Now, if I may for just a moment, I know I'm supposed to be talking about sports, but I have to take a moment to address something that I brought up before. I'm watching Entertainment Tonight last night, and just take a listen to this.
And Us Weekly's Hot Hollywood Party will bring out the young, stylish stars on April 26th in Los Angeles. Ryan Seacrest, Paris Hilton, Carmen Electra, and Stacey Keibler will be on the red carpet, along with Us's style icon of the year, Jessica Alba.
She just has this natural elegance and sexiness without trying too hard.
All of a sudden, Jessica Alba.
On the map.
I mean, she's the icon of the year.
Mm-hmm.
Listen, dynamite lady, beautiful, perfectly nice. We sat next to each other at the Super Bowl, of course, a couple months ago. And ever since then, all you hear about, Jessica Alba this, Jessica, icon of the year. Mm. Listen, I don't know how many times I have to say it. I just want to say for everybody listening, I don't know, whatever you hear, she and I are not together. And I are not an item. Christ, I'm gay. Yeah. I would like just one week to go without having to address this nonsense.
But sometimes the more you defend it, the more it makes it sound true.
Right. Maybe you should just shut up about it. Hear the inflection. Good thing you weren't sitting next to Helen Hunt. Would hate to see her all over Entertainment Tonight. Yes.
Yeah.
You're like a rabbit's foot. Not the lucky one. Just one of the 4 feet that is.
I just wanted to, but I understand she's a dynamite lady, Alba.
But nothing.
We're not an item. It's disrespectful at some point.
I agree.
All right, here's something else that, the big thing, some people are coming down on Musawi for trying to blow up America. Mm-hmm. Other people are coming down on Tiger Woods. And why? Because at the end of the Masters on Sunday, he said this.
I putted atrociously today. As good as I hit it, that's as bad as I putted today. And it was frustrating because I felt so in control of my golf ball from tee to green. And once I got on the green, and I was a spaz.
I was a spaz,
mm-hmm.
right? Not, you know, innocuous talk.
One would think.
But groups, this, the American Disabled for Attending Programs Today, differently abled people, you see.
Mm.
Outrage, spaz.
Oh, really?
So for spastic, and if you have a neurological disorder, it's not that funny.
Let's not defend that, though.
Well, you don't want these people getting together and organizing a drag. I was going to say March, but you know how it goes.
Man.
You're only contributing to
all
the
right.
problem.
That's my point. You know, I'll tell you the most disturbing part about this whole thing is the Los Angeles Times cleaned up his language and put wreck.
Oh, is
in
that
there.
Oh, they took
yes,
the liberty.
Yes, the ultra-liberal Los Angeles Times decided to do us all a favor and save us
our
from
sensitive ears from
save,
spaz.
Yes, from the politically incorrect spaz.
Well,
so
did you know you weren't supposed to say spaz?
No, I didn't know that, but I've been finding out via the radio show. There's a lot of things I didn't know you're supposed to say. I'm just wondering if some right-wing Republican dropped something that was racially disparaging, if the Times would have cleaned it up for him. Yes?
No.
The more you know, think about it. Powerful, powerful stuff.
Well,
go ahead, Spazzo.
The BBC just had a poll that mm-hmm. listed the most offensive ways to describe mentally handicapped people.
Mm-hmm.
Retard is the worst. Spaz is bad. Just so you know, mong.
Right.
I've never heard
like
mongoloid.
Mongoloid?
I've never heard anyone say that, but I guess that would be offensive.
Yeah.
You've got special. I love special. That's a bad one now?
Well, it's going down the list. Eventually, you're just going to you're describing
he'll
a retarded person, so they're all going to be bad.
It's
cripple,
patronizing.
Psycho, handicapped is bad, and wheelchair bound.
It's not bound.
Wheelchair bound is funny because it seems like you're not in your wheelchair yet, but you're heading toward one.
Yes.
Any day now.
Yeah.
And finally, I will close, as I predicted, when Mark the Poet came on segment before and shared a poem. My cousin Brandon in Harrisburg, PA, hates him, and every time Mark the Poet's on, there quickly is a limerick that follows from Brandon, so I'll read one about Mark the Poet. Mark the Poet should never hold a concert because his voice, like American Idol, makes my ears hurt. He thinks poems by Jewel are well-written and cool, and his rhymes bite more ass than Marv Albert.
Not sure if he proved his point there.
I think, well, just the same. Better than Mark the Poet, yes?
How old is this Brandon?
29, 30.
What kind of a man of 30 would go by Brandon? Who names your kids Brandon?
That's my boyfriend's name. Everyone's name is Brandon.
Your boyfriend's name is Brandon?
Yeah. It's a good name.
You can't really be held accountable for the name your parent give you, your parents give you, right?
Yeah. You could. You
what
change
should
he
it. Brandon.
You go by Slick or Dutch.
Brando.
Yeah. You do something.
Cobra.
Brandy. More masculine than Brandon, I would argue. Let's take a break, shall we?
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
We are going to talk Scientology. I'll tell you, it's easy to make fun of Scientology. It's easy to make fun of all the celebrities. I don't know if I know that much about it. And I'm not setting up a joke here. I feel like a lot of people just sort of make fun of it because it's an easy target. And I'm sure we'll get into some of that. But I'm really curious to figure out how it works. Where do you go? What days do you do it? How much money does it cost? What's involved? And whenever you hear about the guys we're making fun of that are doing it, Tom Cruise and Jenna Elfman and John Travolta, they all own jets.
Yep.
If you think about
all
it.
All rich and successful.
Yeah, maybe there's something there. I may be ready to cross over.
Yeah.
We'll take a break. We'll find out about it after this.
You don't understand. It's like you could be a Christian and be a Scientologist. It is a religion because it's dealing with the spirit. You know, you as a spiritual being. And it's something that there's tools that you have that I can actually, that you apply to your life.
Mm-hmm. Edie Rovani.
Yes.
Got that right? She's a Scientologist. She's here to speak. What kind of name is Rovani?
It's Israeli. My husband is Israeli.
Mm-hmm. What's your nationality?
I was born in Hungary.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Speak the language?
Yes, I do.
Oh, well, because it's a great language. My grandfather's Hungarian. It's novelty sounding. So you speak Hungarian?
Yes, sir.
All right. Well, let's see. I'll give you a sentence and you repeat it, all right?
Oh, sure.
Okay. Say, Adam Carolla and Dave Damashek went to Knott's Berry Farm to watch Shrek on IMAX. Come on.
Adam Carroll is Dave Demeshek meant to go to Knott's Berry Farm, but let me share it at IMAX Bay.
Oh, well, there goes that one. That was funny.
There's definitely a language barrier.
How do you pronounce my last name?
Carroll.
Yeah, but wouldn't you just pronounce it how I pronounce it? Or you, I would change it if I moved to Budapest?
You might. I mean, my name is Edith, but in English it's Edith.
Yeah, but your last name, you don't F with that one, do you?
Well, I don't know because I didn't have it when I was born, so I don't really know what it's in, it is in Hungarian.
All right.
This, we are not off to a good start convincing you to join Scientology. You
were I'm going to have to change my last name. So give us the broad. I think a lot of people have fun with Scientology, and they make fun of Tom Cruise and Jenna Elfman and Kirstie Alley and John Travolta and Kelly Preston. I wouldn't mind partying with any of these people.
But Scientologists are embarrassed by Tom Cruise at this point, yes?
Absolutely not.
No. And what about it? I mean, what are the big beats, the broad strokes? If I was to embrace Scientology today, what would I do?
Well, first of all, you have to know what Scientology is, and Scientology is about you. It's about you as a spiritual being, mm-hmm. and your relationship with yourself, your mm-hmm. family, your future children, mm-hmm. Your friends, the group, the world, and the universe. And the more you understand about yourself, the better you understand others, mm-hmm. and you can help. Mm-hmm. And that's pretty much, you know, really what Scientology is about.
What about, you know, if I left my wife and my unborn twins and took up with Anastasia, the 19-year-old blonde surfer in Hermosa Beach. Would there be a problem? I mean, I don't want anything that's going to, you know, get myself in any hot water, karma-wise. You know what I'm saying?
Well, you'd have to ask your wife. You might be in hot water with her.
But not as far as L. Ron goes. I'm in the clear?
Well, you know, you might want to look at it and see why you'd want to do that.
Oh, well, didn't you see her?
No, I didn't. See her? Oh. Sorry.
We'll get her back. You'll understand. Yeah, So far, it sounds a little nebulous to me. Like, I need something I can hang my hat on. Do you have a Sabbath day?
Get into the aliens.
Into the good stuff.
Well, there's the movie Aliens. I don't know anything about it.
What's the Scientology? What is the part where people, you don't have to endorse this, but what are people's misconceptions about Scientology? What do the naysayers say?
Well, I don't really know what they're saying. I mean, there's a lot of things that are said, but that's a tabloids, and I really don't get into tabloids. I don't read them. But somebody who really wants to know about Scientology and honestly wants to know about it picks up a book by L. Ron Hubbard, like Dianetics, and it's really, really explains it clearly in there. And what he discovered in his research is that your mind has basically two parts. There's the part that's you're aware, like what we're doing now, talking, and you can think, and you can recall things.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a part that occurs, it's called what we call the reactive mind or the unconscious mind. When you have an accident and there's pain and unconsciousness during an accident, surgery, and your mind is recording all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what he discovered is his spoken words, when they're being recorded by the part that we call the reactive mind, those words are not analyzed rationally. It's basically like A equals A equals A. So everything means the same thing. So later on, something can trigger those words, and they have an adverse effect on the person.
Sounds like a post-traumatic stress disorder, something like that.
Kind of.
What does this cost? Because I'm fairly frugal.
It doesn't have to cost anything.
Well,
you can go and get Dianetics out of the library. You read the book.
I want to swing by the Celebrity Center on my way home, I'm going to have to feed the kitty, am I not?
No.
No? Well,
actually, no. You can come in. There's, you know, if you want to buy the book. But you know what? You can do it from the book. I mean, people for years just did it, from the
book. How's the food? You guys got good food over there?
I guess.
So if I just swung by the Celebrity Center.
Uh-huh.
I mean, first off, you know, what are they? I think they like celebrities. Everybody does.
The Celebrity Center is for celebrities. That's why it's called the Celebrity Center.
Yeah, I'm just saying. Do you think I could get in?
Absolutely.
Oh, you do?
Absolutely.
Yeah, because the thing about religion, it's not much different than if you make jeans. You want to see Jessica Simpson in them walking down the red carpet.
Right, it helps sell the jeans.
Going to help sales. I think you'd want the Ace Man involved with the Scientology. You know, move some product. Yes?
Well, the reason we have Celebrity Center is not just because of celebrities and who they are. It's the fact is what they do. And, you know, they're out there and they're creating. And the artist is really what's really important in this world, because they're doing something unique.
How does the silent birth thing work? I'm sorry to cut you off, but
okay.
I got twins on the way.
I know, that's
terrific.
And then,
I would like to expand that notion into the silent marriage. Why stop the stopped talking just in the hospital? Why not have that carry over to the ride home, to the dinner table? The relationship
Someone's
with the children and family.
Someone's getting leftovers again tonight.
Yeah.
You could work that out with your wife, but hey, I wouldn't go there.
I like to try it out.
Well, you know, silent birth is really just making it the best, most enjoyable, calm, quiet environment for the mother or your
wife.
So
the kid doesn't come out all jittery.
Well, it's not just coming out all jittery. It's not going to come out all jittery.
Well, an epidural would make the wife comfortable, too, yes?
Let me clarify. The woman, because this is what I've heard about Katie Holmes, that Tom Cruise doesn't want her to make any sound when the child's being born. Is that what it is?
No, that's not what it is. That's changed. That's really not even what he said.
Okay.
What it is, it's the spoken word. It's like I was explaining to you before about the portion of the mind that's recording, and it's the spoken word that triggers. And first of all, it's not even necessarily her. I mean, she's going to make sounds. I don't know any mother that doesn't make sounds. You know? I mean, come on, it's a painful experience. Mm, you know, let's
silent vacation.
Don't tell me anything.
But you mean people in the room might say things, and then the baby would unconsciously hold it in its mind.
Right. It's the people around. It's the people in the room that should not be speaking or making sounds.
Yeah. My mom had a cannon in the room. Actually fired off when I was born, like halftime. It was... I'm still scarred to this day.
But you know what? It's okay, because even, like, you know, people have had babies all kinds of ways, and not everybody has done it this way. And Dianetics handles it all. So it doesn't matter if you had a cannon blast, if your mother was screaming, no, Adam, no, whatever. You know, it's all handled with Dianetics.
How about my dad trying to stuff me back? How about that? Wouldn't that be scarring?
You know what? That's right. Scientology handles that also.
All right. Now, look, we need to take ourselves a quick break. We'll get back to a little more of this.
And when we get back, I want to know the answer to the whole thing that L. Ron Hubbard concocted this religion on a bet.
I've heard that, too.
Yes. All right, hold
You'll
on.
Address this.
Do not answer that. And really give me your pitch when we come back. We only have a few minutes, and I have to make some important decisions for me and my family after this.
This is C. Thomas Howell, and you're listening to the Adam Carolla Show.
Wolverines! I'm going to hire him for my next party to yell Wolverines. A lot of people get, you know, they get Superman or Batman, or maybe they get some stand-up. I'm just going to actually give C. Thomas $150. You just walk around with a platter, you know, jumbo shrimp and yell Wolverines.
Please
about every 20
me.
Minutes. I know.
Wolverines!
You'll not be invited. We are here with Edie Rovini. Rovini. She's a Scientologist. I'm picking a religion. We only have a few moments left. Now, when we left off, Edie, we were speaking about the bet. It's rumored that L. Ron Hubbard came up with this religion on a bet. Do you know anything about that?
Actually, that one I hadn't heard of.
Oh, really?
No.
Never heard it.
Not that one.
I'm always amazed, by the way, where people haven't heard of stuff that pertains to their stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, once in a while, there's a guy with a name or a girl with a name, and you go, oh, you know that song with your name in it? You know, your name is Wendy. You know that Beach Boys song right now? And I'm always like, really?
Who are the Beach Boys, by the way?
Okay.
What about the alien business, then? What about that? I mean, this is the big thing with Scientology. Of course, you must be able to address this.
This is not part of Scientology. I've been in Scientology since 1977. I've never seen anything like that.
But what about
that?
The whole Travolta picture a few years back? What was that one
Battlefield
called?
Earth?
Battlefield Earth. That whole thing was a parable, for the religion.
That's from Battlefield Earth. L. Ron Hubbard was a science fiction writer. And, yes, he wrote about aliens. And so that's...
But there's some correlation, right? Between the alien... isn't the origin of the religion have something to do with the aliens coming to Earth? Earth and populating it and so on and so forth?
No, absolutely
not. That's complete nonsense, you're saying.
It's absolute nonsense.
So it's completely manufactured.
Absolute tabloid stuff.
Never heard of the bat thing.
No one from another planet came to this Earth.
What about past lives? Is there a belief in past lives?
Yes, it's a spiritual being. You live from lifetime to lifetime.
So you believe you're an alien who created a religion on a bet in a past life?
You know what? I've never found that.
All right. We're plumb out of time. I got to say, Edie, while delightful person, you were a little bit evasive, and I'm not sure if you won me over to Scientology. I'll tell you what could do it. Punch the Hooters punching bag. We'll see how many pounds you hit it with. We're having everybody in here. So far, our Buddhists.
Really? The Buddhist?
Yes. The Buddhist so far scored like 478.
Oh, she did. Wow. Did better than the rabbi.
A lot of anger built up. Rabbi got 65. You got 72. That will be factored into your overall score, Edie. Nice job. All right, that's it. Well, it's still anyone's game. I'm looking for a religion. We'll keep going.
One more day.
We're going Muslim tomorrow. Could get heated. All right, who do I want to thank? Gary Greenberg, Super Chew, for coming in here and doing our Passover Seder. Be prepared, a practical book for new dads. Anastasia, Ashley. Oh, la la.
Future Mrs. Carolla.
Yeah, PETA2.com is where you can check her out. Michael Rosenbaum, he's on top of my assistant in Ruska's office right now. Smallville, Thursday nights, 8 o'clock, WB. Edie, thank you for coming in and pushing Scientology. And Teresa Strasser, great job as usual, baby doll. And until next time, this is Adam Carolla saying mahalo.